1973. The team you beat in the semi-final was Tyrone, and the team you beat this year in the semi-final was Tyrone. Any omens there for Cork, do you think?
Well, I think that's a very good omen, and I hope that the lads on Sunday will also pull off the All-Ireland.
And Jimmy Deanahan, this is Kerry's sixth All-Ireland in succession. Do you think high mileage could deny Kerry the title on Sunday?
They may have high mileage, but they make up for it through their skill and through their determination and motivation and that very strong desire to win.
We're all expecting a classic here, but is it possible we mightn't get that on Sunday?
No, I think we will have a classic. Both teams, I'm sure, are very anxious to express themselves in Croke Park, and they're both very skillful teams. And I think we'll have a similar game as the Hurling All-Ireland. We're going to have a great, an epic All-Ireland.
And a quick prediction from both of you, Denny Long.
Well, I think Cork have played great football all year, and I see no reason why they can't win on Sunday. I think they'll win by a few points.
And Jimmy?
I think Kerry are peaking for Sunday, and they'll have their best performance next Sunday, and they'll win.
And I think both of you are expecting a tight game. We'll just have to wait and see. But for the moment, back to you in the studio in Dublin, Colm.
Thanks, Pascal. Interesting thoughts there. What price, I wonder, the draw? That's Friday, 6-1 Sports News, back now.
Obviously, I suppose we'd like to think that there was a learning curve there for people, in the sense that, you know, look, we're quite close, we're getting there, we're progressing in the right path, but, you know, we have to push on from that. You know, a lot has been said about that Tyrone result. You know, Tyrone are obviously a very good team, you know, having won 3 All-Irelands in the last decade, but the reality is they were without Sean Cavanagh that day. True work of that performance will be judged in our performance at the All-Ireland final. We seem to keep popping up against one another, no matter how hard we might try to stay apart. We are, but, you know, we're looking forward. It's a big game. We just have to go out there and give it a lash and, you know, try to perform to our ability. And, you know, if we do that, we're in with a right good chance. And, you know, if that isn't good enough, then so be it. You get an opportunity in terms of an All-Ireland final. You might only get one shot at it. You need to take it. Now, from our point of view, I'd be approaching this in a very positive manner and, you know, hoping that we'll get a positive outcome. The reality is, in sport, you play for the now and not for tomorrow.
Thoughts of the Cork manager, Conor Cunahan. We'll be hearing from Jack O'Connor in a little while. Let's head down pitch side right now. Marty Morrissey is there, and he has met up with a couple of well-known faces.
Thank you very much, Michael. Yes, wonderful pageantry here at Croke Park and a carnival atmosphere as the build-up to the All-Ireland Football Final really begins. I'm joined by two real legends of Gaelic football, Coleman Corrigan of Cork, 2 All-Ireland senior medals, and a man beside him, Tommy Doyle, with 7 All-Ireland medals and captain of the 1986 team. Coleman Corrigan, 3 weeks ago, we were all kind of feeling that Cork might be the favourites, but as the throw-in time comes a little bit near, there's a feeling that Kerry might just pull the wool over your eyes. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, that might be coming more from the Kerry supporters, from the Cork supporters. I really feel that if Cork get off to the type of start that they did against Tyrone, they're in with a great chance, and they've been playing well all year. It's a matter of who's going to get primary possession in the middle of the field, I feel, because both sets of forwards are exceptionally good. I think Cork's pace across the half-forward line might be the trump card, and if we can get enough ball into our full-forward line with the likes of Daniel Goulding and O'Neill, we can do a lot of damage inside there. So I think a good start is the main.
You've an added interest, of course, Coleman, because your nephew is part of the squad here, Fintan Gould.
That's right, yeah. Fintan came onto the panel a few years ago, and quite possibly probably came on a small bit too young. But over the last couple of years, he's suffered one or two injuries, but he's come back really strong, and I'm delighted for him. And I think he can make a huge impact when he does come on today, if he does come on.
Tommy Doyle, I know you're now living in Cork in Ballincollig, so as a Kerry man, you've, I'm sure, enjoyed the last week.
Ah, great week, Marty. Great banter with the lads and Cork fellas, meeting a lot of former players like myself, my own age, grew up around the city. Great crack, and this is fantastic.
Kerry to win?
I go along with what Coleman says. Cork's pace could be a problem to us, but we've got two guys. If Paul Gallivan, who's a fantastic guy, fantastic player, and Tighe Kennelly, if they can play the type of game we need them to play, I think we're in there with a great chance.
Tommy Doyle, Coleman Corrigan, thank you both for joining us. From a wonderful atmosphere on the pitch, let's go back up to the studio. Michael Lester.
Yeah, Marty, it is a wonderful atmosphere on the pitch. There's great colour, and of course this is the 125th anniversary of the GA. There's one of the Cork minors there. And Well, I'm not sure which of the Kerry players that is, Pat.
Dragging the leg, I'm a bit worried.
He's dragging the leg, yes.
Maybe it's a fitness test we're looking at, Michael.
Well, it's great to see a great atmosphere, isn't it, Colin? And,
there is, but I could do without that beating of the drum. Oh,
see, endlessly, you know, I think it put people off. But, like, there is great colours, great. But it's one of the great sporting things in the whole world, you know. It compares favourably, and the Irish people watching all over the world today, and for them, this is a special part of home.
I think that stuff there, you know, we could be doing without that in fireworks. So, I mean, what happened to the RTM Boys band playing the tunes from the various counties and all that? It's great, you know, like all Ireland Friendly is like a religious ceremony.
Ah,
you know,
Joe,
you
we got get not Joe.
You know, it's like Butland's holiday camp, you know.
The fireworks display.
Colm's never been to Butland's holiday camp. He gets paid far too much.
It's a very good effort, Michael, in fairness. It creates to the atmosphere.
I'm enjoying it.
The only thing about it is this country. Every pageant we do in this country has to have fellas beating drums, and surely they got
five the last quarter last year. And what Cork will bring is that 70 minutes of ferocity and intensity and tackling and hard graft. And it'll be an awful shame if this Kerry team go down in history as a team that, you know, were thoroughbreds, but they weren't manly enough to really rise to the challenge, you know, whenever somebody really put it up to them.
But no matter how many times you see the Kerry team running out onto the field in Croke Park for all them final days, still a proud man.
Ah, yeah. Look, you know, we're a proud county, and, you know, I mean, we like to get into All-Ireland Finals. We like to win All-Ireland Finals. But the important thing about it, win or lose, if you win an All-Ireland Final in Kerry, by Wednesday, I can tell you this, it's forgotten. If we lose an All-Ireland Final, we'll take our beat in Manly and we move on again. Because next year, 2010 championship, all your successes of 2009 are forgotten about. And that's what drives Kerry, this passing on the torch, this winning of All-Ireland medals. It's a very, very proud tradition, and, you know, it's the dream of every. I've been privileged to have played and represented Kerry in Croke Park, and it always makes one proud to see one's county run out an All-Ireland final day in Croke Park.
Yeah. Now, a little while ago, we heard from the Cork manager, Conor Coonahan. I also recently met up with the Kerry boss, Jack O'Connor. 5 years ago, he was the man in charge when Kerry pulled off a big win over Mayo in the final. The campaign of 2009 has been a bit bumpier so far, with a few trials and tribulations along the way.
You write a book with Tom Humphries, he's not going to be beaten around the bush or allow you to beat around the bush, you know, you're going to have to be to the point, and I thought it was better off to write the book, honestly. And, you know, if I told a couple of yarns about players here and there, sure, I mean, after you win All-Ireland, you can say whatever you want, basically. You know, you get away with murder. So, you know, I didn't feel as if I betrayed anybody. But sure, some people thought I did and made a big deal about it, you know. Tom Humphries asked me during the year sometime, you know, Jack, is the book going to be an issue? And I said, Tom, the book will be an issue if we lose. Yeah, but that's the nature of the beast down here. It's like an industry in itself, the rumour mill. And I'm sure people get great fun out of it. It's a form of entertainment. So, you know, once the players don't, start believing it and start getting carried away with it, there's no problem. We were basically only interested in what was happening in training, not what people were talking about. So it didn't affect us to the degree that people thought it was, you know. The last time was very successful. We reached three finals and we won two of them. And beaten by a great Tyrone side in 2005. To be honest with you, I think the Tyrone issue is a bigger factor with the fans and the media than it is with the Kerry players. It wasn't as if Jack O'Connor was going to come back and Tyrone were going to fall their way and all the rest of it. Any day you lose to Cork as a setback, and we lost fairly comprehensively to them in the replay above in Parky Cleeve. And you'd have to say that at the time that things looked bleak for us, because, you know, Cork ran through us in the last quarter and all of that game. But, you know, the great thing for us is that we had a second chance, and it was funny, you know, as a management, we were standing on the sideline with 15 minutes to go, and I was kind of saying, listen, lads, we need to look out there now and see what remedial action we can take to improve the situation. And basically we had 3 weeks before the first qualifier to get our act together, and we did rejig the team a bit, and obviously brought back likes of Michael McCarthy, put Tommy Griffin full back, with Seamus Ganlon coming into the team, who had been injured for a good part of the year, and gradually rejigged the team a bit and tried to get the balance right, because we knew ourselves what we had in Parky Cleeve wasn't going to be good enough. We're not in the business of just being there, you know, to reach finals. We're in the business of trying to win them. So we're well aware that we'd have our hands full with these Cork fillers, but we just think we're in a better position to play them now than we were in June. This team won't be around forever, and they've a good bit of mileage in the clock, and some fellas pushing on a bit. So, you know, they'll only really appreciate this team when they're gone. We'll face a fierce, tough test with our neighbours here on Sunday, and the fact of the matter is, you might think there's rivalry between Kerry and Tyrone, but there's nothing to thrive between Kerry and Cork, and it's a big, big game for both sets of players and supporters.
Well, Kerry, of course, the market leaders in Gaelic football, are bidding for a fifth All-Ireland title this decade. Some record. The Kingdom showing one change from the team which started against Meath in the semi-final. Tommy Walsh is preferred to his namesake Donica Walsh. He starts at full forward with Declan O'Sullivan moving onto the 40. It's an eighth All-Ireland final for cornerback Tom O'Sullivan and the O'Shea brothers from Ord the Vohir. Remember, Dara was missing for the 0-4 final because of an injury. Well, Cork were anxious to name the same 15 once again. There's been a concern about Ray Carey, number two there in that graphic, and I think he's not going to play, and I think he may well be replaced by Kieran O'Connor. Anthony Lynch and Nicholas Murphy are playing in a third All-Ireland final, still looking for that elusive winner's medal. Nine players in all remain from the team beaten by Kerry in the 2009 final. A tenth, Daniel Goulding, came on in that match and finished with a goal and a point. Well, so much for the team lineouts. Let's now take a closer look at today's finalists with Martin Carney, and we're starting, Martin, with Kerry and Dermot Murphy.
Yeah, Dermot has a very sound season so far, and again you could ask the question, would they be here today without a save against Sligo in the last minute?
Loads of experience in Kerry's fullback line.
Yeah, a lot of experience. Tommy Griffin is somewhat unorthodox, and he's fond of whatever it takes school of fullback play, and I think he could be vulnerable to a player with some guile. But O'Sullivan and Mark O'Shea, outstanding cornerbacks.
Of course, the half line here features the return of Mike McCarthy.
Yeah, I think his return has revitalised the line. There's a solidness there again. There's a freshness about it. And its experience will be needed to curb Pearce O'Neill today.
And it's a tried and trusted midfield then. O'Shea and Scanlon.
Yeah, very much so. There's real presence in Darragh O'Shea, but I think this guy, Seamus O'Scanlon, is a wonderful support to him. Tireless player, uses possession well, and will play as an extra centre-half back.
What about the half-forward line then? Flair and talent here.
Well, flair and talent, but great talent from Paul Galvin in particular, my player of the year so far. Again, Declan O'Sullivan, expect him to play anywhere. But it's a lovely little subplot about Ty Kennelly coming home, forsaking a professional game and playing in an All-Ireland final.
And then your thoughts on the inside line?
Well, genius Colm Cooper, capable of the unexpected, goals in important games. Tommy Walsh won through the last day, deserves to be recalled. And Darren O'Sullivan, a good ball winner. Maybe doesn't let the ball go quickly enough, but an outstanding captain nonetheless.
All right, let's turn to Cork now. And back for his second All-Ireland final is Alan Quirk.
Yeah, well, he has been prone to the occasional error in big games, but again secured this year and he really bombs his kickouts.
Right, the full back line. I'm mentioning a possible change here at number two.
Well, that's going to be interesting. Maybe Kieran O'Connor will come in, but Micheál Shields has played with great dash and aggression this year, and Anthony Lynch, really, his role is critical in curbing Colm Cooper.
Well, I suppose it's from half back that Cork seriously mount many of their attacks.
Yeah, that's their platinum line. I mean, the leadership, the example, and the tigerish, you know, forward thrust that Canty gives it. Noel O'Leary, all passion, and on the other side, you know, John Miskell is a real dynamo.
Once again, then, it's O'Connor and it's Murphy in midfield.
Yeah, Nicholas Murphy, a fine fielder, and less prominent this year, and again, has in the past been unable to deal with Darragh O'Shea, but beside him, I think, Alan O'Connor, outstanding work rate throughout.
There's certainly plenty of pace and variety in this next line.
Yeah, there's youthful confidence with the likes of Paul Kerrigan. Pearce O'Neill, his pace is the ability to unsettle Kerry, but they need a massive game from him. And the other side, Paddy Keddy, hugely understated, and his decision making is outstanding.
And then finally, how do you rate this full forward line?
Well, I think Daniel Goulding is a real gem. Colm O'Neill, I should say, is a precocious talent, plays with great poise. And in the other corner, Donal O'Connor, his place kicking needs to be spot on today, and I'd like to see him playing with a little bit more assurance.
Okay, Martin, thank you very much indeed. Well, Cork, I can tell you, have won the toss. Canty, the captain, indicated that they would play from right to left. Not a great deal of breeze around this afternoon, Michael.
No, there is not, Jorkeng. It's an absolutely beautiful day here in Dublin. Perfect conditions for the match. Now, we can confirm, Colm O'Rourke, that change we were talking about in the Cork team. Kieran O'Connor coming in, wearing number 17 for Ray Carey at right cornerback.
Yeah, I think that will weaken the Cork team. Kieran O'Connor is small and has had difficulty in the past. I presume they certainly wouldn't ask him to play on Tommy Walsh, because I would expect that Tommy Walsh would play left corner forward, Declan O'Sullivan to move into full forward, and Kennelly to play on at centre half forward. So Kieran O'Connor would have a serious size disadvantage if he ended up on Tommy Walsh. They'll probably send him to Mark Darren O'Sullivan, I would think, and leave some of the bigger players inside, because obviously Anthony Lynch will pick up Cooper. So Cork may have a slight difficulty there with their marking arrangements at the back.
Well, the belief in Kerry is that they're going to play a two-man full forward line with Tommy Walsh and Gooch Cooper as the two-man full forward line, and playing Darren out.
I mean, this forces Michael Shields to pick up Walsh, which could be a real mismatch, because although Tommy can be a bit of a liability if he doesn't start well, you know, he can turn a game in a trice.
Sure.
And Shields laboured very badly under the high balls against Donegal. I mean, Michael Murphy had him in his pocket, and that's a real worry there. And I think that Shields is bound to be, because he had a personal disaster in 2007. Yeah. He's going to be extremely nervous about this today. And Tommy doesn't really care about that type of thing, you know.
Sure. Yeah.
And when we talk about the size of the Cork team, it's an absolutely huge team,
except from their full back line,
where they probably need one really big player, like, you know, the likes of Pearson Neal and Nicholas Murphy and Alan O'Connor, huge size, but all their size is really around the middle of the pitch.
More pressure now on the Cork defence all around then, Pat Brian. Fellas like Graham Canty, their centre-back and their captain there, he will have to hold the whole thing together now in a bigger way.
He will indeed. I mean, look, Kerry will take Limerick's game plan in the Munster final as their template today. I mean, Limerick showed how this Cork team can be beaten, and one of the key things is stopping the likes of Canty, stopping Noel O'Leary from building up from the back, because Cork's attacks come from the back. Against Kerry in the two matches, the Kerry forward line's work rate was absolutely abysmal. They didn't defend when they lost possession, so which meant that Cork players were coming up and the support player was always in. So if you can put that Cork back line, particularly that Cork half back line, on the defensive, then Kerry have gone a long way towards it. So there's a big onus on the likes of Paul Galvin and all those to track back, work hard. Now, there is a question mark over Paul Galvin, because Paul Galvin hasn't trained fully since the meet game. So he has a problem with his groin. The expectation is that he will not last 70 minutes. That's what they believe in, because he hasn't pushed himself to the extreme. So Galvin has been probably Kerry's player of the year thus far. But like the big thing, and like you look at three players that Kerry have this year that they didn't have in the All-Ireland final last year: Mike McCarthy, Tyke Kennelly and Paul Galvin. They're three big players. It's a different Kerry team this year.
And this is an amazing story, I suppose, for Tyke Kennelly, Colm O'Rourke. ambition to play in All-Ireland final, played, of course, Aussie rules for many years successfully, and now back and playing in All-Ireland final.
Yeah, I suppose it's the story of coming back to reclaim the family silver, you know, and I suppose he won't rest until he actually wins an All-Ireland medal. And I can understand that, like, no matter what you get in life, you know, once you grow up in a tradition of Gaelic games, to win an All-Ireland medal with your county has to be the ultimate, and to win a county championship with your club.
See your dad lift the cup.
Yeah, absolutely.
It sort of emphasises the separateness of Kerry. You know, could you imagine if he was from Derry saying, you know, my ambition is to come and win an All-Ireland senior title with Derry? You know, it's a much more remote prospect there.
But he has added greatly to the Kerry team. Like, against Meath, I think he was on the ball more often than any other player, himself and Galvin. I think that they will play a big part today.
Okay, well, now it's time for the introduction of Oaktharona Héireann, Mary McAleese, and she's accompanied by her husband, Martin.
Yes, President Mary McAleese undertaking the official part of her afternoon in Croke Park by meeting the All-Ireland finalists, accompanied by Christy Cooney, Oaktharona Common Luke.
Today. We saw on the shot there, and mentioned as well, Pat Spillane, Marty Duffy, referee from Sligo here today. We wish him well, big day for him and for his officials. He needs to have a grip on this one.
Well, you know, he's a referee. I don't particularly like his refereeing style, because I think he refs too much by the book, and, you know, common sense doesn't seem to be taken into the equation at all. I would have had Paganini, but we wish him the best of luck. We will hope that at the end of the game that we don't have to talk about him at all. But unfortunately, an awful lot of the games that Matty Duffy refs, he becomes the subject of discussion, which he shouldn't be. But
this isn't the best.
He'll have two sporting teams anyway.
This isn't the day for a box ticking exercise.
No, it's not, Joe. But no. The thing about it is, it won't be Marty Duffy's fault if trouble starts down the field. That's one, I suppose, it might be. Bit of a fear we might have.
It might be, you know.
Well, sometimes, you know, a good referee has a feel for a game and he understands what's happening between the players. I'm quite sure it'll be a sporting game. The last time I made the comment about Marty Duffy, I think I insulted all the small men.
You're a sizes pigger. Honestly.
I hope he does well. I hope he does well. But, you know, it's up to the players, too, to ensure that it's an easy job for him.
Joe Brawley's pass... our Kane boys band, Pascalan, are there as he requested a little bit earlier on. So we're a few minutes just away from the throw-in, about 5 minutes, Pat. Can Kerry do it? Can Kerry put it all behind them and win the All-Ireland title?
I think they can, based on a few things. If they can increase the work rate, if they can move the ball quick and long, if they keep the Cork half back line on the defence, it's a lot of ifs and buts and whatever it is. Kerry have the experience. Cork are the better footballing team and have been the better footballing team all year. But the All-Ireland final is decided over the next 70 minutes. And I just think maybe Kerry's experience of the big day will see them over the line. And what I believe will be a great struggle, because what you have is two teams who will set out their stall positively and play to their strengths. I'm looking forward to it.
Colin.
Well, I don't think it's going to be anything like 2007 when it was a walkover. I wouldn't agree with Pat that Cork are a better footballing side, because Kerry have the proven pedigree when it comes to football quality in All-Ireland finals.
I think footballing side this year.
Yeah, well, I think there's a bit of a doubt over the Cork scoring forwards. I wouldn't be gone on that inside line that Cork have. Kerry have proven in the past that when it comes to the big day, they normally turn up trumps. So for me, it's the old dog for the hard road, Kerry to win.
No time for doubts, Joe Brawley.
No, I think that... You know, it's a huge test for Kerry, because I do think that, you know, it'll be a great disappointment. You know, it'll be an anticlimactic end to a decade of what ought to have been, you know, stellar achievement, because they're stellar footballers. And the only reason that they won't win today, if they don't win, is because they're just not able to put their backs to the wheel. And that's what happened against Tyrone on three occasions. I think it's a different Kerry team now. You know, there's something about the ruthless dispatch of Dublin and of Neve the last day, the way they cruised through the league remorselessly. I don't think Munster really matters. And I just feel all around that although Cork will get ripped into them for 70 minutes, and Cork could easily win the game because they've got vast desire and they've got the equipment now and the athleticism to do so, I just think that in the round, Kerry will have a wee bit too much. You know, so I think Kerry today, Cork tomorrow.
All right, that's the view from the panel. It's the All-Ireland Football Final of 2009. It's time to find out indeed who is going to claim the big prize in the championship. In the commentary box, Ger Canning and Martin Carney.
Thank you very much indeed, Michael. It's the final part of the pre-match programme then, as we prepare for the third final in 7 years involving teams from the same province. And what about the goalkeeper for Cork? Well, he's going to have some week, you know. Here he is playing in his second All-Ireland football final. And next Saturday, he marries the lovely Katrina. And I'll tell you something, a replay is certainly not on their agenda. Well, the best of luck to them. He's got more than football on his mind, very, very clearly. And I'm hearing about a man called Tim Holland, who comes from Cork. And I'm told that Tim is here today, and he's attending his 136th consecutive All-Ireland final. Football and hurling, clearly. I tell you, that's a testimony to good health and a very good ticket supplier as well. The managers are looking suitably tense down on the sideline. Jack O'Connor, who came back, won two All-Irelands, 04 and 06. With Ger O'Keefe there, one of his selectors. Martin Carney's alongside me. What do you expect?
Well, I'd expect Kerry will try and set the initiative at the very, very outset, because one thing they want to try and avoid is allowing Cork to get the upper hand from an early stage. Cork, on the other hand, will try to use their athleticism, in particular from their half-back line. They'll try and spread the game out. To counter that, I expect a hugely aggressive display from the Kerry half-forward line. I think Tim Connelly from the outset will probably take up Graham Canty, neutralise Graham Canty, keep Graham Canty in the back foot. On top of that, I'd say John Miskela also will be again put under an awful lot of pressure, because if Cork are to win, then that has to be the source, that half-back line of theirs has to be the source of all that is good. Kerry, on the other hand, then up front, it'll be interesting to see what role they will give Declan O'Sullivan. I'd imagine they'll play him at the edge of the square.
I think he'd go in full forward.
Yeah, I think so. I think he'll go in full forward. I think
Welch probably going top of the left, and possibly Kennelly out there, as you say, doing that match-up on Canty.
That's right, and Darren O'Sullivan moving out also. But the other guy I'm really looking forward to is Paul Galvin. I really hope he is a stormer today.
Well, before the action gets underway, the Artane boys and girls are poised for the playing of our own Nevea. Over 82,000 people are here in Croke Park to see the closest of neighbours, the keenest of rivals, but there's been a sharp edge to the competition between these Cork and Kerry players for the past couple of years now. So what will the 2009 final produce? Kerry against Cork, the 120th ever All-Ireland football final, referee today by Marty Duffy from Sligo. And the opening 15 minutes are expected to be highly paced and somewhat frenetic. The Kerry fans are ready. Walsh has gone in there for starters anyway, in on that Michael Shields. The umpires are going back into their positions. All is ready and raring to go. Marty Duffy just checking that everybody's inside the respective lines where they're supposed to be. Inside the 45. And the All-Ireland football final gets underway, and it's Cork to play from left to right, and straight away Nicholas Murphy hit there as that ball was coming towards him from the throw-in. And straight away, he's going to require some attention. Watch this again here. Watch the elbow, and it was Kennelly coming across there. It was a high elbow.
Yeah. Tyke seemed overcharged, definitely, in that case. Again, very aroused at the moment, and certainly came in, the elbow was high, and again, Nicholas Murphy turning into him, just got it right in the puss. That's a hard rattle, and Marty Duffy probably will set down the law immediately and issue a yellow card.
Well, the last time he was in a major final, he was wearing the red and white of the Sydney Swans. Conor Coonan concerned about his midfielder, Nicholas Murphy, the Carriga lineman, attended to there by the physio. Just watch it again here. Kennelly coming in here. Did catch him. Oh, that was high. Cork trying to mount the first attack. And Tom O'Sullivan getting there straight away. The left corner back. Linking up here with Mark O'Shea. Now Tommy Griffin has come back and played at full back for Kerry. Second time he's been asked to do that in Championship football in the last number of years. Darrow O'Shea trying to work it out of trouble. Still inside his own 45-metre line. Carried forward here by Tom O'Sullivan. Here's Mike McCarthy, down as far as Kennelly. Hoofed it on only as far as Michael Shields. Didn't see a card for Kennelly, was there one?
No, definitely no card for Kennelly. Maybe just Marty Duffy certainly took a lenient view of it.
As Shields goes, Shields is tripped. Falls over the outstretched legs of Declan O'Sullivan, and the referee awards the free kick, which Noel O'Leary is preparing to take. Here as far as Murphy once again, happily recovered. Up as far as Donico O'Connor. Switching across. Looking for some end product at the end of all of this. It's Alan O'Connor who comes through here. Looking for the opening score of the match, and that's very askew indeed. Ironically, he had just scored his first ever championship point, you might remember, against Tyrone a few weeks ago, before he got that second yellow card.
Yeah, but that tactic we see there, midfielders and halfbacks taking the ball off their half-forward line, is something that we see repeatedly from Cork today. They're standing at that. A little bit more steadiness was needed with that finish.
Dermot Murphy. Cork would be expected to dominate the kickouts in midfield. They get this first one from Kerry. There towards Paul Kerrigan. And Kerrigan is held. It's going to be a free in for Cork.
Incidentally, the two wing forwards have switched. Tomás O'Shea is on Kerrigan at the moment, and Killian Young is picking up Patrick Kelly.
Would you have expected that?
Wouldn't have really. I would have thought it would have, you know, that Kerrigan would have stayed over and allowed Killian Young to be on him. But again, it's one of the moves I wouldn't expect. Certainly, I expected Kennelly to be playing on Canty.
So it's Donico O'Connor then. Deep intake of breath. 10th time playing Kerry in the championship, looking to open the scoring here. Catches it well. That's a confidently struck shot, and it's over the bar. Well, like all free takers, he's so highly dependent on confidence, and that will be a huge boost right from the outset here. Inside the right-hand post, 3.5 minutes are gone, and Cork take the lead.
Yes, in the past he has suffered a little bit from having missed early scores. That one certainly will do his confidence a lot of good. And again, he's such a fine footballer. It's a shame to see that diffidence kicking in big days occasionally.
Just a mention of the breeze, by the way. It is a very, very still afternoon in Croke Park. But up near the other end, near Hill 60, there's always a somewhat contrary breeze. Kerry attacked that goal right now. And here comes Kennelly. looking to try and tie up the scores, gets away from the would-be challenge, hits it in very confidently and puts it over the bar. Great score for Ty Kennelly, man of the match against Meath in the semi-final. Well, he took it in his stride here brilliantly, struck it well. Beautiful point.
Beautiful point indeed. Wonderful running on the angle that time by Kennelly. And again, it's a feature of his game that's improved hugely, is the kicking inside of the foot from a difficult angle. That's a lovely score.
Of course, his dad played 7 times in the All-Ireland final and captained Kerry to victory 30 years ago. This is broken down to Seamus Scanlon this time. Picked up here by Paul Galvin. Support available. That's Tomás O'Shea. Missed there by Paddy Kelly. Seized on here, however, by Declan O'Sullivan, looking for another score. Declan O'Sullivan, this spells danger. Cork get players back. Lynch tries to get it away. Helped out here by Miskala. Fed away out towards Anthony Lynch. Still Lynch, shouldered that time there by Darren O'Sullivan. Scrambling for possession here. It's O'Leary who picks it up. Sent inside there towards Colm O'Neill. Broken back down here towards Galvin once again. He'll do a lot of the foraging. Helped there by Darrow O'Shea. Supported here by young Killian Young. He's just 22 years of age. Tom O'Sullivan now having an outstanding year since his switch back to left corner back. The captain, Darren O'Sullivan, out around the half forward lines. Struggling to get the ball away. And hit rather aimlessly. Graham Canty onto it quickly. Has options now. One of them here, John Miskala. Great running. Picked up here by Dalek O'Connor. Lovely diagonal run across. Tracked there by Mark O'Shea. Trying to make a more favourable angle for himself. Runs into the challenge of Galvin. Ball scrambled loose. Picked up again here by Mike McCarthy. The centre half back. Out as far as Seamus Scanlon. Kicked forward to Kennelly. Again has support players on his shoulder. Tomás O'Shea, left-footed kick down, all the way towards Tommy Welsh, slipping, runs on for the goalkeeper and Quirk, linking up here with Michael Shields. Very deep running there by Paul Kerrigan to go way, way back to Forage. Here he is again, taking it from Canty, his captain. He's made up a lot of ground. Clever ball inside. Again, good defending. That was Tom O'Sullivan out to it first. Really good cornerback play. Linking up with Scanlon. Knocked ahead towards Declan O'Sullivan. And Kieran O'Sullivan, or Kieran O'Connor rather, in there to match up with him. But it breaks favourably here for Killian Young. Run back again by Nicholas Murphy. There's great pace to the match. Comes up here as far as Paddy Kelly. Still Kelly. Been allowed to carry it forward a good 20, 30 metres. But it's a rather aimless final ball. He was anticipating either Colm O'Neill or the other quarter forward to be able to get at the end of it, Daniel Goulding, but it came to naught.
Yeah, as you said, there's great pace of the game, great rhythm by both sides, and I must say the tackling so far has been crisp and effective from both sides. Again, both sides are getting plenty of players behind the ball. Yeah.
Oof, dear, oh dear.
Yes, that's definitely, he came down with his foot on Kieran O'Connor that time, whether it's accidental or not, I don't know about that.
That looked like a stumble, but it isn't pleasant to look at. Comes back towards Colm O'Neill once again, kicking off his left this time. Beautiful kick, and he puts it over the bar. Well, there were questions being asked about the young players, in particular the young forwards that Cork have in their team today, whether they might freeze on the big occasion. But this Colm O'Neill is a very, very good player. He'll be 21 on Tuesday, looking for an early birthday present. 2-1 to Cork.
Yeah, as you said, a very precocious player. And again, I would fear for Tommy Griffin in some ways, playing on a player like O'Neill, because he is so much guile.
Knocked down this time by Darrow O'Shea, but knocked down only as far as Paddy Kelly. Once again, it's Nicholas Murphy holding off Paul Galvin. And hit straight to the one man he didn't want to hit it to, Tom O'Sullivan, the left corner back. Here comes Tomás O'Shea. Good running again by Ty Kennelly, and the running of Kennelly is excellent so far. He's dragging Graham Canty this way and that, and Cork will need Graham Canty to be a pivotal figure at centre half back. That time he's helped out by Alan O'Connor. O'Leary gets it out as far as Kieran O'Connor. Plenty of O'Connors playing for Cork. Here comes Canty, seen now as an attacking force. Beautiful ball, measured perfectly for Colm O'Neill. Released quickly to Paddy Kelly. Can he finish? Hoping it'll draw in sufficiently. It's moving, it's travelling, and it's gone between the post and over the bar. Excellent point by Cork and by Paddy Kelly. Lovely counter-attack. Brilliant movement. And Cork lead the match by 3-1.
That's an absolutely wonderful score. A wonderful piece of movement by the in the Cork forward line. But again, Kelly's confidence that time from a difficult angle to take the point without going around his man. Just wonderful. That was a really, really, really cut draw.
Kerry now trying to win this kick out and set up an attack of their own. It breaks. And once again, it's Graham Canty. And this time, Kennelly is allowing him to get away loose and needs to do a bit of defending. Donnacha O'Connor running into Galvin. Referee blows the whistle. Shake of the head by Paul Galvin. Let's have a look at it again here. Yeah. Oh, not much doubt about that.
Well, that's clumsy and that's aggressive. And again, referee is, you know, he's not issuing yellow cards.
Oh, O'Neill's after it. Oh, what a goal by Colm O'Neill! 10 minutes are gone. It's the opening goal of the game. And Colm O'Neill gets his first ever championship goal. And what a time to do it in the All-Ireland final against the great old rivals from Kerry. Getting onto that loose ball. Already causing problems for his marker, Tommy Griffin, who lost him. And O'Neill, what a most brilliant finish from an acute angle. And Dermot Murphy was beaten, and well beaten, at the near post. At the other end, it's Graham Canty who picks it up. Cork have been winning most of Kerry's kick-outs so far. That's 5 out of 6 that they've won. Here comes Miskala. He's got great running. Picked up here by Tom O'Sullivan. Nearly 11 minutes gone. Kerry with just one solitary point, credited to Ty Kennelly. Now Darren O'Sullivan, their captain, setting off here, supported by Paul Galvin. Galvin looking over his shoulder to see where was the nearest Cork man. And as he did so, in came the block of Kieran O'Connor. Still got a bit of work to do here. Galvin holding on to it, showing composure. Murphy goes back, that's Nicholas Murphy. Tips it back, it's Tommy Walsh who gets there first. Two Cork men in there to challenge him. Look at the strength, look at the resolution of Tommy Walsh. Good vision as well to pick out Killian Young. Supported here by Kennelly. Oh, trying to pick out Young, succeeds. Kerry still have it. Needs some finish here. Darrow O'Shea kicks it straight away to a loose Cork man, and that's John Miskala, who is fouled by Darren O'Sullivan, and it's a free out to Cork. And there was some lovely play there by Kerry, but it failed to produce a final shot.
Cork have settled really well. Again, going back to the goal. Goal was absolutely wonderfully created, but beautifully finished by Colm O'Neill. He's causing Tommy Griffin a huge amount of trouble back down there in the full back line.
As Mark O'Shea gets forward this time. Cork have been very disciplined so far. Haven't conceded a free to Kerry. They're still being disciplined. Back it comes here once again towards Declan O'Sullivan. Here comes Seamus Scanlon. Now the Gooch. Need to see him in action. Lynch tracking him. That's got to be some matchup. Anthony Lynch versus Colm Cooper. And this time a foul blown for by the referee. Free conceded. Chance for Kerry to get a score.
Yeah, and it's the first time he's really had a pause for breath. The game has been played at a relentless pace. Again, some fantastic football from both sides. But again, the Cork full forward line seems to have the edge in the Kerry full back line at the moment. I think Golding has been very active. Donald O'Connor, obviously. But Colm O'Neill is the star turn so far. And Tommy Griffin has really struggled with his pace and with his cuteness.
This is only Kerry's second scoring chance. It's Colm Gooch Cooper with the point from the free. Well, most of his scores in this year's championship have come from frees, it should be pointed out.
Yeah, and just going back to the goal again, just great movement again and lovely thinking with the free taker. But again, O'Neill's movement in the space was top class. Tommy Griffin didn't read it quickly enough. The goal was absolutely beautifully taken.
As Alan Quirk gets ready to kick this one out. Seamus Scanlon in control. Waiting for support, it's Tomás O'Shea. Kerry won't panic. Tommy Walsh trying to get the measure of the challenge there by Michael Shields. Shields trying to get tight. Walsh looking for a support player. That support player was Cooper. And back there to help out as Miskala got into Cooper in the referee's view from behind. Just watch this challenge again now, again by Miskala. He was trying to go shoulder to shoulder The referee didn't see it like that and awards the free into Kerry.
Well, you could say it's a soft enough free, actually, though. Again, if you notice, he put his foot across him in order to try and get the ball away, and I think he may have tripped him. But again, in the way he's refereed the game so far, that's a soft enough free.
This to put just a goal between the teams. Colin Cooper with 20 pointed frees already in the championship. Make it 21. His second of the day, and it's 1-3 to 3 points. 14 minutes are gone. Well, it's been the kind of frantic all-action, high-tempo match that Jack O'Connor and others will have expected. I'm sure Kerry wanted to see what Cork would be like if Cork had to come from behind, as they had to in the match against Limerick, in particular in the Munster final.
Yeah, what is noticeable too in the Cork full forward line, they're playing very much out of the side, they're leaving great space down there.
That kick out is won there by Darren O'Sullivan of Kerry. Ball left behind, however, by Cooper initially. Now pushed out over the line by Alan O'Connor, who would appear, and the referee decides that it's going to be a line ball. Cooper carried it out. Cork will have the possession. The big man Alan O'Connor will take this from St. Columb's, which is a junior club. He's the only junior club player, in fact, playing in the Cork team this afternoon. Trying to make headway against Seamus Scanlon. Darrow Shea's in there as well. Will Darrow have a full 70 minutes in him? The way in which Kerry have been playing this season in the championship, Micheál Quirk very often comes in to replace Darrow Shea. Say with about 15 minutes to go. I'm sure the game plan is to tell Darrow, right, do as much as you possibly can for a game, for at least 75% of the match. This ball is up towards Donico O'Connor. A point from a free already. His marker is Mark O'Shea. Fed inside towards Pierce O'Neill. Having a great season. Back once again it comes. O'Connor, that's Stanek O'Connor, feeding it in dangerously to Goulding, who got the final touch. Well, Daniel Goulding feels it was his man, but the umpire thought otherwise.
Well, I think it was a case there. Let's just watch that again. Yes, I think it was Thomas Sullivan got the final touch in that. Yes, definitely Thomas Sullivan got the last touch in that. Should have been a 45.
Interesting, just looking around, Martin, at Darren O'Sullivan in particular. They're bringing him very, very deep on occasions, especially when Kerry lose possession. Get onto the sideline and just get some up-to-date from our reporter down there is Marty Morrissey. Marty.
Chair, just an observation. Eamon Fitzmaurice has been dispatched by Jack O'Connor to go down to have a word with Tommy Griffin. And the advice is to play Colm O'Neill from the front. No change yet. They're not making any changes in terms of the full back line, but to try and get Tommy to play Colm O'Neill from the front.
Thanks, Marty. No panic. So let's see how that develops in the next couple of minutes, because as you were suggesting, Tommy Griffin really has his hands full against Colm O'Neill. Golden point already,
but the key thing about the Cork forward line, they're playing very wide. They're leaving the situation there where it's one against one any time the ball comes in. They're giving themselves a huge amount of space with which to contest the ball with their immediate opponents.
Well, Donico O'Connor has pointed one free already. Cork haven't a score now for some 8 minutes, so this to maintain. A nice scoring pattern from their point of view. Nicely over the bar. Two from two from Donico O'Connor. And it's 1-4 to 3 points. So far so good for Conor Cunahan's team.
Very much so. The team that have settled better. They're the team that are getting on the ball better around the middle of the field, in particular from breaks. And again, at the back in particular, the Cork full back line are in control, even though I would fear for Kieran O'Connor, who's marking Declan O'Sullivan.
This time it bypasses midfield and Nicholas Murphy has to go back, forage and wait for it to go out over the sideline. Ty Kennelly today playing in what is just his sixth championship match. Paddy Kelly forced backwards by Killian Young. Interesting duel between two very young and very talented players. Michael Shields almost in two minds. Tommy Walsh chasing him. Tommy Walsh's best part of his game is certainly as an attacking force. Now he's having to chase back, and it's Shields who's taking it forward. Loves to attack. Not a good final ball, however. Not quite sure who that was intended for. Maybe Donico O'Connor, but it was his man Mark O'Shea who got there. Now Darrow O'Shea back towards Seamus Scanlon. Here's Declan O'Sullivan. Lovely turn. Lost Kieran O'Connor. Good running across here by Gooch. There once again is Anthony Lynch and Alice Farris, Paul Kerrigan. A very, very tasty duel between the two of them. Lynch once again here. He won the match down in Porticui between the two players. Hands down, really, or hands up, one or the other. He was superb that afternoon. Out once again to Dara O'Shea now. Cleverly fed to Declan O'Sullivan, who returns it beautifully to Tomás O'Shea. Lobbed in towards Kennelly. Fed back here to Tommy Welch. Being shown the target, and he finds the target perfectly. Good score by Tommy Welch. His first point of the match. Lovely little interplay there between Ty Kennelly and Tommy Welch. And when eventually Welch was poised to pull the trigger, you saw Kennelly there pointing the way, saying, there you are, have a go. He did, and it's 1-4 to 4 points.
Yes, that's a lovely interchange of passes between Kennelly and Welch. And again, a beautiful crossfield ball that Kennelly did very well to win. But again, the need to get a lot more possession around the middle of the field. And interesting, the last attack that Cork had is the first time I've seen Tommy Griffin coming out and hitting the ball.
The way Kerry have been using their possession is very interesting so far, Martin. They've had four attacks, they've had four scores. Four shots at the target. Let's see what this fifth one can produce. It produces another one for Tommy Welch. And Tommy Welch gets two in a row. Great play. And it's 1-4 to 5 points. Two between them.
The essence of simplicity again. Kick out one, dispatched quickly to Tommy Walsh. Didn't take his man on, shot it over the bar. Great score. Now, we may be critical of him when he doesn't track back, but by God, when he gets a ball in scoring range, he's absolutely lethal.
Time for the kick out for Cork, and they've done very poorly on their own kick out so far. They've lost four so far, but they've been winning Kerry's kick out. That time there was a push in the back by Dara O'Shea. So free to the reigning Munster champions. Paddy Kelly going back to Nicholas Murphy. Midway through this first half. Murphy against Dara O'Shea. They've had some battles here in Croke Park in the past. Oh, the hand pass goes as far as Miskella, but there were two players lying on the deck at the end of it. Here's Colm O'Neill beating Tommy Griffin, hitting it in, but hitting it wide. Pulling it to the near post that time. Won't have been pleased with the kick, but he's got a goal and a point so far. Four wides for Cork. 21 minutes gone.
Yeah, he probably should have taken on Tommy Griffin that time. He had space to do it. Again, no support there around Tommy Griffin to help him out. But just going back, that, there was nothing malicious whatsoever in that collision between Paul Galvin and Nicholas Murphy.
Yeah, absolutely. Well caught there by Dara O'Shea. Galvin releasing it. Young involved. You know, the matchup that we were anticipating between Paul Galvin and Noel O'Leary, that hasn't materialised.
No, nobody has poured petrol on a jet anyway.
They've been portrayed, of course, in the build-up to all of this as the pantomime villains. I won't call them the ugly sisters. No, here comes Miskella. Kerry defending, and it's Griffin who gets it. And Kerry have taken a bit of a grip on midfield in the last few moments. Here comes Killian Young. There goes Killian Young. He's still moving. It's left for Tommy Walsh. Trying to place it in there. In two minds, really. Not exactly a pass to Colm Cooper. And there were a couple of other options as well.
Well, I don't think the pass was intended for Colm Cooper. Mike McCarthy had made a wonderful overlap, actually, into space. The pass was slightly overcooked, which was a shame from a Kerry point of view. But you're right in saying, at the moment, Kerry, surprisingly, are winning it well around the middle of the field. I would have expected a little bit more from the likes of Pearce O'Neill in terms of winning primary possession.
Jim Nolan there, one of the selectors, alongside his manager, Conor Cunahan. Into the middle again, and it's a jersey pull there by Alan O'Connor, I think, on Seamus Scanlon. Referee blows his whistle, free awarded to Paul Galvin. Down as far as Declan O'Sullivan, trying to cut through the Cork defence, again held there by Kieran O'Connor, who's having his problems very definitely.
Very much so, and if I were the Kerry manager, which thankfully I'm not, I will be getting to play the ball more and more to Declan O'Sullivan. He is the beating of Kieran O'Connor, and I think the loss of Ray Carey has been sorely felt, and don't be surprised if there's a Cork back sub coming in a couple of minutes.
Well, Kieran O'Connor has just been noted by the referee for that. No black cards shown anymore, but any more offences like that and he will be getting a yellow card. So Colm Cooper, 2 points from freeze so far. 22 metres out, no real difficulty. straight over. So it's 1-4 to 6 points, and Cork still leading, but now the lead is down to a solitary point.
Yeah, and again, Kerry have responded magnificently since the concession of that goal. In fact, they have gone and scored, is it 4 points since then, or 3 points since then, but they've been in control around the middle of the park in particular.
That goal after 10 minutes by Colm O'Neill has been hugely important from Cork's point of view, but Kerry have fought back and fought back strongly here, and Cork concede yet another free kick. It's Kieran O'Connor again conceding to Declan O'Sullivan, sent in brilliantly there. Colm Cooper in alongside Lynch, right on the end line, looking for latitude, looking for a support player. Darren O'Sullivan swings it back again towards Kennelly, and Kennelly hits it, but he puts it wide. A really good chance.
Great opportunity, but I must say the coordination that time between Declan O'Sullivan and Colm Cooper was absolutely wonderful. Beautifully flighted score, or flighted pass, I should say, but great defensive play by Anthony Lynch in keeping him out. But Kennelly will be disappointed with the overall finish.
Well, that is only their first attacking foray that went wide of the target. I think the experience that Kerry have had playing in six finals on the trot is suddenly beginning to come to the fore here. We mentioned that they don't do panic. Now it's up to Cork to fight their way back into this, although they are still ahead by a solitary point.
Yeah, that was the first kick out in a while that has gone straight down the middle into Pearce O'Neill. It's the first kick out they have won on a break in a while.
Canty kicking, O'Neill drifting away, lost possession however. Tomás O'Shea's after it, Paul Kerrigan's there as well, haven't seen too much of him. It's brilliantly released as far as Mark O'Shea. Oh, he's made a good 40-50 metres. Declan O'Sullivan calling for it, steadying himself and setting up an attack in there for Cooper. Brilliantly transferred to Galvin, there's a scoring chance here, fisting it, but fisting it wide, and the late challenge coming in there from Noel O'Leary was absolutely vital and essential.
Wonderful piece of defensive play that time by O'Leary, great alertness by O'Leary. Oh, what a piece of interplay by the Kerry forwards that time. Beautiful off the ball movement, wonderful variation in terms of the passing, and the Kerry at the moment, when they get the ball into the forwards, they're starting to make a lot of ground in there, and the person again I think is responsible for a lot is Declan O'Sullivan.
Well, some great defensive work that time by a combination of Noel O'Leary and Graham Canty, foiling Paul Galvin. Kelly jumping, missing it. Pearce O'Neill takes it instead. The man playing on the 40. Back towards Noel O'Leary. Looking around, seeing Canty ready to try and push through the centre. Kennelly goes into challenge. It breaks there for Alan O'Connor. He's foul. Or he picks the ball off the ground, the referee has decided. That's the call.
Yeah, good call.
Paul Galvin ready to hit the free kick as we watch it once again here. Yeah, he did it, pick it up. The referee got it spot on. Here comes Declan O'Sullivan. Again, it's Declan O'Sullivan. He really is hugely impressive. What a talent, and what a shot. Teams are level. It's been coming. Level for the second time in the match. But it's Declan O'Sullivan, his wonderful through movement here, getting it onto the right boot, and struck sweetly between the posts. And Kieran O'Connor is certainly finding him an enormous handful in this All-Ireland final.
Well, that's a really sweetly sculptured score in the way he took it. He took on the ball, he went in direct and straight lines, but the way he finished it again, absolutely delightful. But he's been a real threat over the last 10 minutes.
Cork haven't scored for 10 minutes. It's Kerry who are lording it in midfield. Darrow Shea and Seamus Scanlon. They've had some combination over the years. Indeed, looking at the record of the two Kerry midfielders, it's the 17th time that they've been playing together today in the Championship. That's a challenge there on Mark O'Shea, which is penalised. And the record of the two midfielders, by the way, is very good. They've won 12 of the 16 matches where they've been paired so far. Watch for the stray hand here, catching.
Well, in fairness to
Mark O'Shea, he was reaching out.
Nobody had slipped. Mark O'Shea had slipped, in all fairness, and I wouldn't blame the Cork player whatsoever in that instance.
Certainly it wasn't intentional. I merely said he'd think he was reaching out, and just the whole thing didn't quite reach the finish that he intended with a challenge. Now
What happened there actually is that Marty Dudley has noticed Anthony Lynch holding on to Colm Cooper before the free kick was taken, and as a consequence of that he's actually awarding a free in from the place where this incident took place.
And it's an opportunity for Kerry to go in front of the match. It'll be for the first time. Shake of the head by Anthony Lynch. Cooper has got three so far. This ideally plays for a man who's got a kick with the left boot. So an opportunity for Kerry fans then to find their voices once again. The lead changes and it's Kerry 8, Cork 1 goal and 4 points, 8 points to 7.
Yeah, and again, the Cork defence, who were on top so well early on, just need to be that little bit disciplined and not give away soft free kicks like that. And I notice now actually that Miskell has gone on to actually Declan O'Sullivan, which isn't before time.
Absolutely. Well, here we are in the 30th minute, and since Cork's goal after 10 minutes, they've had just one score. Here comes Paul Galvin. All Kerry. Here's Kennelly from that pass by Galvin. Onto his right. Cracking it brilliantly and putting it over. A second for Ty Kennelly, the man who came back from the Sydney Swans because he wanted to do what his brother has done and what his father has done before him, and that's come and play in an All-Ireland final, and more particularly pick up an All-Ireland medal. Will it be his day?
Yeah, but the hot carrier it was who got the ball from that time, Paul Galvin, a wonderful assist. Again, Kennelly's enthusiasm is infectious. You could see his delight in scoring that point. And again, Graham Canty has not had the impact that we would have expected up to now because of his difficulties in looking after Kennelly.
So far, the way Kerry have set up their team is working perfectly. Here's Canty. There's a lot of football in Graham Canty. There's a whole lot of determination as well. An outstanding captain. Ready to take this free kick. 5 minutes to go to half-time. O'Connor contests. Goulding in there as well. Seen very little of Daniel Goulding. Here he is now. Needs to get onto the left-hand side to crack over a score, and that will do his confidence a real power of good. Daniel Goulding, who's got 2 goals and 17 points now in this year's championship, took it inside Tom O'Sullivan, made an angle for himself, and put it over the bar.
Yes, certainly, that was a great point. I think it's about their first score in about 12 minutes or so, or 14 minutes actually. Again, good score, one-on-one, confidence to go onto his left foot, and again, cracked a fine score.
Kerry win the resultant kick out through Darrow O'Shea. Mike McCarthy has pushed ahead of him there. Across once more towards Declan O'Sullivan. Everything is going to him and through him. Tomás O'Shea has a quick little look up to see just what's on. Knocking it in here towards Colm Cooper, and Tommy Walsh spills away from them, and it's won by Michael Shields. The St Finbar's man getting it forward here towards Noel O'Leary from Kilmamartra. Waiting for a support player. Back out from O'Connor to Michael Shields. Cork looking for another score. Players to aim at inside. Oh. Donico O'Connor slipped and Galvin was back to help out, and it's out as far as Seamus Scanlon. Great pace in the match. Trying to measure this ball across here towards Mark O'Shea, and a lot of work to do over there. There was a foul committed anyway, and Kerry were ready to take the ball away, but the referee had blown his whistle.
Yes, I was fascinated to watch the role that Paul Galvin played in that last Cork attack. He didn't bother about O'Leary whatsoever. He just sprinted back into his old full back line, and who got the breaking ball when it came in? Galvin. Very, very good reading of the situation.
Just seems to me, looking at Paul Galvin this year, that he's trying to make up for the lost year last year when he was suspended for so much of the summer. Came in as a sub against Tyrone in the second half of the final. Tomás O'Shea belting at a huge distance down. Cooper, did he nudge Lynch in the back? Got away with it anyway. Colm Cooper still onto the left, and Cooper is for the ball wide. Just as it was coming towards him, I think he might well have just touched Anthony Lynch out of the way.
I think we would call it a judicious nudge. He certainly got a little bit of a hip into his back that time, and again, probably justice was done by when he put the ball wide.
Fourth wide for Kerry. Fascinating final. Kerry shaking it. So far, so good for Jack O'Connor's team. There's the scoring chances, 12 created by Kerry, 8 created by Conor Cunahan's team. Alan O'Connor trying to win it in midfield, but it's mostly Kerry. They've taken a firm command here, and from that midfield grip, which was expected to be Cork's strong point, they've taken over, and they have scorers coming right, left and centre. The latest one, Tomás O'Shea, second point in this year's championship, first of the day here. Kerry lead by 2.
Wonderful to watch though, again Scanlon that time picking up the break, Pearson Lee not being able to get on the end of those kickouts from Alan Quirk, but again O'Shea's footballing instincts were manifest that time. Wonderful score from a fantastic footballer.
I remember the great goal he got against Tyrone in the final here some 4 years ago. 2 minutes of additional time are going to be played at the end of the opening 35. That's Alan O'Connor trying to drag Cork forward. Kerrigan trying to place it this time, and now Kerry have settled to the task at the back, and Tommy Griffin is looking a lot more confident, supported by Mark O'Shea and Tom O'Sullivan, his two cornerbacks, and they can break again here. From number 2 to number 4, it's O'Sullivan getting it forward here, inevitably to Declan O'Sullivan. He's like an old-style telephone operator, everything has to go through him. Back to O'Sullivan again.
It's a lovely description.
On there towards Tomás O'Shea. Cut out here by Graham Canty, and inside the referee saw Anthony Lynch and Colin Cooper, and he's got to have words. Michael Shields going across to plead a case for Anthony Lynch, but Lynch is the one who's been drawn over here by Marty Duffy, the referee from Sligo, refereeing his first ever senior football final. He's refereed a women's senior football final much earlier in the decade. And that's a yellow card for Anthony Lynch.
Well, certainly that's a yellow card that he didn't have to actually, he didn't need to concede, and that Cork don't need to have, you know, have him take off. But again, they have both been at it. One has been at, you know, and it happened in that case again that Lynch was caught out. But Cooper also has been given little nudges here and there, but hasn't been caught so far.
Well, you might remember the match in Porky Cueve, the replayed semi-final, when Lynch really won that hands down against Colin Cooper. I'm sure Cooper went in and said, it's not going to happen again. And Cooper has got another point from that free. That's 5 points from frees in the first half for Colin Cooper. We're in the second minute of injury time, and Kerry are leading the match by 3 points. Well, Cork will be very, very concerned, I think, with the way their scoring rate has dropped alarmingly over the last 26 minutes of this match. They've only got 2 points. At the time when they got the goal after 10 minutes, it was looking like everything was going Cork's way. There's a Cork player down on the ground at the moment, Nicholas Murphy. He's getting up rather gingerly as his colleague Alan O'Connor carries this forward. Maybe one more play in the last couple of seconds of this first half. Donegh O'Connor trying to close the gap on Kerry. Knocked ahead towards the goal scorer, Colm O'Neill. Trying to get there ahead of Tommy Griffin, who has settled to the task. And that's going to be a 45, first of the match for Cork. Tommy Griffin, the publican from Dingle, will be very, very pleased with the way the game has gone for the last 20 minutes after a bit of a nightmarish opening 10.
Yeah, it was very, very bad opening, and again, the ball, the quality of the ball at that time coming into Colm O'Neill, Donegh O'Connor and Daniel Golding was top class. But the source, the tap has been turned off around the middle of the field through the sheer work rate of the Kerry middle eight. And again, the likes of Galvin, the likes of Titanelli, Declan O'Sullivan have been really the dominant group of players.
Well, this 45 has been entrusted to Colm O'Neill to take. You might remember he came on in the draw match in Killarney back in June, Munster semi-final. Just came on, and Cork needed a free taker from a 45, and he put it over the bar. That was in a more central position. As you can see, this is right on the sideline. Now, can he get it over from here? The CIT student, it's going to drop short. How many seconds are left? Daniel Goulding is upended just outside the large square, and it's going to be a free in. And there's a point here for the taking for Cork, which can bring them back within 2 points of Kerry heading into the interval break.
Yeah, again, the Kerry defence kind of no complaints about that one. That was a definite, you know, two or three of them fouled them. And it's a simple enough end to the half, actually, for Daniel Goulding. Simple enough opportunity.
Goulding with 1 point already from play, one now from
a free as referee Marty Duffy blows the half-time whistle in the All-Ireland football final. Cork started well and got the game's only goal after 10 minutes through Colm O'Neill, but then Kerry took over. Colm Cooper got 4-5 points from frees, but Kerry's dominance around the middle of the park meant that they had opportunities time and again to attack the Cork defence, and they took them in style and with a fair degree of regularity. And Kerry, I think, will be much the happier going in at the break here. It's Kerry 11 points, Cork 1 goal and 6. Michael.
And I think we're all happy that this is a really good, lively game of football. Joe Brolly, Colm O'Rourke and Pat Spillane with me here on the panel. Pat, happy enough at half-time, 2 points up, and really got stuck into that game.
Fascinating, in a very enjoyable first half. Michael Cox set out their stall in the first 10 minutes, isolated Colm O'Neill and Tommy Griffin, and they got 1-1 out of it. But then Kerry took over for this. After 10 minutes, Kerry took over. They dominated that middle third of the field. The key players in Cork, Graham Canty is getting a roasting from Ty Kennelly. Midfield, Kerry are winning midfield, and the Cork's attacking prowess from the half back line is non-existent. So it's been a very good performance by Kerry for the last 20 minutes. But like I said, the game is still in the melting pot.
Jase, Colm O'Rourke?
Yeah, I think actually Cork are fortunate to be as close as they are, because Kerry played all the football really for the last 25 minutes of the half. They've got their marking arrangements right, and Kennelly has taken Graham Canty to the cleaners. Canty's now back in on Tommy Walsh. But I think of more concern to Cork is Pearse O'Neill hasn't featured in the game at all, and their two midfielders have been more or less out of it. But all the best individual players in the first half have nearly all been on the Kerry side.
People talk about a game of two halves, Joe. This has been a half of two games.
I know, it's been a demonstration by Kerry after the first 10 minutes. And, you know, I'm glad from the neutrals' point of view that Cork had that whirlwind start, because Kerry have demonstrated their superiority all over the field. And it is a joy to watch them against Cork's scrambled defence. It's their awareness. You know, you can't... You know, so often when you're at club level, you're saying to boys, get your head up when you get the ball. You know, you don't have to go on solo runs. Get your head up. Go to the open space. Look for the diagonal ball. And they're doing that beautifully. And really, Cork are very lucky only to be 2 points behind.
Okay, we're going to take a short break here in the programme. More from the panel right after that. Hey, it's half-time at the All-Ireland Football Final. This is how things stand. Kerry leading Cork by 11 points to 1 goal in 6 points, and that's in front of an attendance here today of 82,286. Joe Brolly, Colm O'Rourke and Pat Spillane with me here in studio. All the right things happened for Cork early on in the game. Got off to a blazing start, Joe, and then, of course, Colm O'Neill's goal, and that was the real rabble-rouser.
But they needed it. They badly needed a good start, you know, to wipe out past memories and to confirm the fact that they're worthy to be here today. And O'Neill's goal, I must say, was a thing of absolute beauty. He did everything right. He took a look at where the keeper was. He put it in the near post. It was taken with such aplomb. It's hard to believe that he's only 20, but beautifully taken.
At that stage of the game, too, Colm O'Neill was really on top of Tommy Griffin, and it looked trouble. But in the last 15 minutes of the half, Griffin has got to grips with O'Neill and has won most of the 50-50 balls that have come in.
But I think that's primarily because they're kicking in high ball now on top of Goulding and O'Neill. And they can't do that. I mean, Daniel Goulding and O'Neill look really as if they can run riot off their men. I mean, just a basic thing. Goulding came in along the touchline. He had to come out onto his left foot. Tom O'Sullivan let him to come out onto his left foot to kick a point. And clearly, if the ball's going in low there, conversely, if Kerry would start kicking diagonal long balls into Tommy Walsh, the game could have been over by halftime.
It wasn't just the goal they got, Colm O'Rourke. Cork also got a couple of excellent points early on. They're from indeed O'Neill got a good point as well. And Kelly in that.
O'Neill was on fire early on. You know, the young fella in All-Ireland final, no fear, plenty of confidence in his own ability. You know, this came before the goal. If he came after the goal, you'd say he was on a high. But, like, you know, he set out his stall from early on. And then, of course, Paddy Kelly, I'd say that, you know, when you were a back there and pushing a fella wide, you would say it's safe enough. But Kelly got a lot of ball early on too. But, you know, he has drifted out of the game in company with most of the Cork players, because Kerry have been sort of relentless, coming from five down, you know, and went three up. So that's an 8 point turnover. And Kennelly missed an easy point. Galvin missed an easy point. So Kerry have been relentless in sort of reeling in Cork. And if they get a goal early in the second half, you know, you'd fear for Cork.
It's a sign of a class team, Pat. It has to be said that when you're under the cosh, fellas stand up to it. Tommy Walsh stood up to it, Tygan Ellis stood up to it, Declan O'Sullivan, in terms of getting scores.
Yeah, well, these boys have been through many battles, and one thing they have is plenty composure, plenty experience, and they won't panic. And like Joe said, I mean, some of the forward play in that first half from Kerry was magnificent. Diagonal ball, high, over to Tim Kennelly, and look, beautiful point by. There's great support there. Everything that's good in forward play was exhibited here. And again, look, it's moving the ball quick and long, playing it into space. And look, even in this position, Walsh is that's 40 metres out, bad angle. And it's a great point.
But I think you could also see...
And sorry, Joe, this is the best point, sorry. Declan O'Sullivan, soaring with the left foot. He's giving Kieran O'Connor a torrid afternoon. And then turning onto his right foot, which is his weaker foot, and taking a lovely point.
And Ty Kennelly is contributing well.
Well, Ty Kennelly has been brilliant in the first half. Both himself and Galvin have sort of cropped up more often than probably any other players in possession. But the greatest mismatch is Kieran O'Connor and Declan O'Sullivan. I can't understand how Cork have allowed that to continue. I thought they'd have taken them off earlier.
And the funny thing about the Kerry forward line is that Darren O'Sullivan, the captain, is absolutely not in the game. And Gooch, while he's kicked five great frees, Gooch is not the same Gooch as last year, because Gooch's work rate off the ball is not what is required.
Don't forget that the reason that Darren O'Sullivan's in the half forward line is to stop Maskela playing, and he's taken him out of the game entirely. You can see how much Kerry have learned over the last 4 or 5 years, and how much Jack O'Connor has learned. You know, last year Kerry were just running into the Tyrone traps. They were being swarmed, the ball was being taken off them, and every setback was demoralising to the Kerry crowd and to the Kerry team. This year in the first half, Cork were reliant on creating that sort of atmosphere, and they haven't been able to do it. I mean, Kerry have stepped away from the traps, they've moved the ball beautifully. Ty Kennelly has had a massive influence in the game. You can't get a handle on him. I mean, he's appearing here in his 21-yard line, he's moving the ball beautifully to the extent that Graham Canty hasn't touched the ball. Now they've moved Graham Canty back in on Tommy Walsh, which is a mark of his superiority.
He was a massive influence in that first half, but he was looking maybe Colm O'Rourke, that things might have gone against him in the very first minute of the game.
Yeah, in the first minute of the game on the throw, you know, when Nicholas Murphy takes the ball and Kennelly is coming in. Now, Kennelly's coming in at pace and Murphy turns into him. I think the referee has had a good first half. Kennelly
that's
is fortunate. Fortunate to get away with that. It's.
I mean, let's be fair about it.
He hits him with his shoulder right into the field.
Call it what it is. Yeah. Call it what it is. That was a straight red, lads. You've got to call it what it is.
You know, if it had happened maybe 10 minutes later, he'd have been in trouble. Yeah, you know, if you're going to have a serious incident in the first minute, the chances of getting sent off in the first minute are slim to none. But was it a sending off offence? I think it was, Michael.
It was not.
Certainly was a yellow card offence, but I will admit, Matty Duffy's had a good game.
Excellent.
Okay, time for us to take another break here in the programme. The second half of Kerry versus Cork is coming up straight after that. And also, there's a big prize for you to win. So, to Son Oisin, hope you're enjoying the match. Here come the Kerry team. Pat, can you hold out? Can you win this one?
Well, a repeat of the last 20 minutes performance like that, we'll see Kerry coming through. I mean, Cork need a big 10 minutes, and if Cork don't have a big 10 minutes, well, then Kerry get a push in them, Kerry get a 5 or 6 point lead, I think it's Kerry's. It's Kerry's to lose, Michael.
Colin?
Well, Cork, you started off with great power and pace, but, you know, Kerry, you know, after 10 minutes got to grip with it, and, you know, Kerry have been by far the most comfortable team in the last 20 minutes. Yeah. Unless Kerry run out of steam, which is unlikely, I think Kerry should win.
Cork can only win.
Change on the Cork team, by the way. Owen Cadigan has come in for Kieran O'Connor.
Not unexpected, because their fullback line's in trouble, and Anthony Lynch is now in trouble with the yellow card. For Cork to win this game, they're dependent on absolute ferocity in the tackle, and they haven't shown that in the last 20 minutes.
Ready to go for the second half. It's back to Ger Canning and Martin Carney.
So that's confirmed then that Owen Cadigan has come in. He's come in for his third championship match. Played the second half as a sub against Meath last in 07, 2 years ago, and he was in the semi-final again this year. So that's the only change made at half-time. 2 points between them. Start of the second half, and it's now Kerry under pressure immediately from that flick forward by Nicholas Murphy. That's O'Neill trying to link up with Alan O'Connor. It breaks down, however. Let's see now who can make the best possible start of the second half. Mike McCarthy. Bounces out of the fist there of Noel O'Leary. Picked up again by Kerry's Tom O'Sullivan. Partly stopped there by Nicholas Murphy. Does well to reclaim it. Pressure applied on Goulding. Gets it back here as far as his captain, Graham Canty. Paddy Kelly now hit one marvellous point in the first half. Trying to break free from the control of Killian Young. Inside here towards Cadigan. First touch. Paddy Kelly back once again towards Paul Kerrigan. Didn't see an awful lot of him in the first half. Has a go. And he has missed the target by several yards. So it remains at 11 points to 1-6.
Yeah, what was a feature of that attack is how lateral it was. There was nobody, doing correct movement in the full forward line. And again, you know, poor shot, bad shot selection, you could say, from Paul Kerry.
Just looking around the marking now, the back for Cork. And Cadigan's gone over there to pick up Tommy Walsh, who's at top of the left at this stage. Declan O'Sullivan's gone in full forward. And Miskela has gone in to cover Declan O'Sullivan. That's interesting. Out here as far as Paddy Kelly. Chased there by Young. Gets it back towards Nicholas Murphy. Darrow O'Shea trying to put in a challenge. It's his brother Mark who gets it away, but kicks straight back to a Cork man, back to Paddy Kelly. And Kerry have gone way, way back in defence to defend here. Colm O'Neill couldn't take it. It's Tom O'Sullivan instead, getting away from Goulding's despairing challenge. O'Sullivan trying to compose himself, hounded there again by Noel O'Leary, fouled.
Yeah, what's fascinating actually is that there are 12 Kerry players behind the ball. There is absolutely no half forward line whatsoever. It looks as if they've gone back into a shell and tried to kind of invite Cork onto them and then maybe then take them on the break.
Almost reminded me of Cork against Tyrone, but Cork were down to 14 at that stage for the second half and they had to defend. That is Ty Kennelly. And it'll be a line ball to Cork, which Graham Canty will take.
Yeah, Cork need a really spirited opening quarter and to get back into contention and to go ahead of Kerry, but they really need to get their scores on the board very quickly.
Muscala breaking out of defence. Forward here for Colm O'Neill over Dunnock O'Connor. And the referee saw a trip there by Mark O'Shea, and it's going to be a free to Cork. Cork needing scores. Two between them, but they need that big, big boost of a decent second half performance. This is going to be taken by Daniel Goulding. Got 2 points in the first half. Second of those coming from a free. So 3 minutes into the second half, then a chance to narrow the gap to 1 point. It's going to drop to the right, and it's another missed opportunity. Never really caught it properly, and that's six wides now for Conor Cunahan's team.
Yeah, they're on top at the moment in terms of getting ball forward. But again, they've got to take the opportunities like that, both from frees and as an earlier one, you know, from open play. That was a bad miss.
Well, the crowd now getting behind both teams. Kerry fans appreciating that their team maybe needs a lift. And Cork people getting right behind their favourites. They've been given a free as well. Alan O'Connor was ready to take it, but not from the correct position.
Yeah, Alan O'Connor started the second half with great purpose, and again he was dormant actually for quite a bit of the first half, but again it's good to see him coming out of his shell.
Plenty of movement inside now by the inside forwards. That's very well taken by Tom O'Sullivan, keeping a very close eye on Daniel Goulding, not really giving him much opportunity. And back goes Galvin to Forage. He's been everywhere this afternoon in this match, and here he is again, Paul Galvin, man from Finnoog. Darrow O'Shea towards Kennelly, trying to open up the play here, does well to hold on to it, and he had Graham Canty breathing down his neck, and the referee says Canty fouled him. Looked like Kennelly fell, took the ball with him, he was then poised to challenge.
Yeah, it was a lovely ball actually from Darrow O'Shea to Kennelly moving into it again. You know, it's a soft enough free in the circumstances.
This goes forward to Declan O'Sullivan anyway, and Declan O'Sullivan had his jersey pulled by John Miskela. His marker, it's going to be a free in for the Kingdom and a chance for them then to get a point on the boards.
Yeah, that's madness actually, some of the frees that Cork are conceding at the moment. They should know by now that Marty Duffy has a thing about pulling jerseys, has a thing about holding on to players. And again, you know, they should have talked about that issue among themselves and not be conceding simple frees like this to Kerry.
Colm Cooper to kick this. He's kicked five in the first half. And he opens the scoring in the second, his sixth pointed free, and now he is the leading scorer in this year's championship. And Kerry have a three-point advantage.
Positive thing at the moment for Cork is that maybe they're getting on top of midfield. That was a good conversion at that time by Cooper.
But having said all of that, this great diamond that everybody was talking about, Canty, O'Connor, Murphy and O'Neill, that hasn't really blossomed so far. Maybe it will in the second. That's taken by Nicholas Murphy. Fouled.
It's fascinating, actually, the way the kickouts are going. They're playing the players wide, their midfield is wide, and they O'Neill coming up the middle. It worked that time.
Here's Dullico O'Connor trying to check inside. Onto his left. Doesn't measure it as he wanted, however. They're getting the opportunities, they're getting the chances at the start of this second half now. And still, they're unable to add to their half-time tally.
Yeah, that's a bad miss that time again. A good attack, good running into space by O'Connor. Got it onto his left foot, should have taken that score.
Well, three wide so far, and certainly a young Sarah Kate Nestor, who's a young Cork fan, only 8 years of age, she won't be too pleased with what she's seen. But right now it's Kerry, who are denied possession because the ball had gone out over the sideline here, in spite of the best endeavours of Tomás O'Shea, the man from Anguilltuck, watch it again here.
Just about. I think all the ball was over the line that time.
Paul Kerrigan ready to hit this. Still trying to make an impact in this match. His dad played in an All-Ireland final way back in 1987. A converted wing back to corner forward he was. And a good one at that as well, Jimmy. Here's Paddy Kelly. As far as Noel O'Leary. Cork are experiencing quite a degree of frustration in this match right now. Kerry, the old masters, have been here so many times before. Graham Canty trying to cut through. It may be the 120th final, football final, as Colm O'Neill kicks it and kicks it in, and it's gone out for a 45, second of the match for Cork. They'll maintain the pressure on Kerry's goal. It's, as I say, the 120th final, but Kerry have now appeared in 54 of those. Not quite half the finals so far, but as near as makes no difference.
Yeah, a lot of the Cork attacks at the moment lack in decisiveness. They're often getting the ball quickly, and if you notice in that last one, actually, it had allowed Darrow O'Shea to get back into his full back line to actually give away that 45. Just too slow in getting the ball forward, and not enough moving in the full forward line to make themselves targets.
Well, unless Cork can punish them by taking these frees and converting their opportunities, Kerry are going to be pretty comfortable about the way in which they face the remaining minutes of this All-Ireland final. Dominic O'Connor hitting it, and Dominic O'Connor has put another one wide. Well, this is, I think, the word they sometimes use, squandermania, because they are kicking it away, and Conor Coonahan must be considering another possible change in personnel.
Well, certainly he's trying to rouse his team and get them to, you know, get spirit going again, and then the Cork crowd are getting behind them. But there's no doubt about it, misses like that can deflate and nibble away at your confidence.
Darrow O'Shea breaking it down, waiting for another Kerry man to come, and the system inevitably, Galvin was coming in. The referee, however, blows his whistle as Galvin's fouled, and it's a free to Kerry, which Darrow O'Shea himself will take. One here by Darren O'Sullivan, ready to take on Anthony Lynch. Darting run this way and that. This player has great pace. Great penetrating run. Oh, an impossible angle, and he's kicked it over the bar. What about that for a score and a first in the match by the Kerry captain, Darren O'Sullivan, applauded by the fans who've come up from the southwest. I thought he had run out of space. He certainly seemed to have no angle whatsoever to hit this ball. Lynch,
he bounced it twice.
Yeah, he did bounce it twice.
Yep.
Well, it may be one that shouldn't have counted, but he got away with it. Kerry got the point. And it's 13-9 in points. Four between them. And Cork have yet to score in the second half. And we're now nearly 10 minutes into the second half as Michael Shields comes forward here. It's a very business-like approach here by Shields. Now, how will they finish it off? Oh, it's kicked away again. Complete breakdown. Lack of cohesion. And utter frustration for Colm O'Neill, the full forward.
Remember, the cohesion in the pass and the actual precision and that coordination came from the likes of Canty, came from the likes of Pearse O'Neill at centre-half forward. But so far today, they have been really ineffective. They haven't been able to leave their stamp on the game. And unless and until such times as they come up and raise their game, they flourish.
The big difference of the second half so far, Martin, with over 10 minutes gone. Cork have had four scoring chances and they've missed each one of those scoring chances. Kerry have had two. taken both of them, including the last one by Darren O'Sullivan, two bounces and all. Here's Canale, very, very deep. In fact, it's Mike McCarthy, chased there by Nicholas Murphy, released here for Darren O'Shea, out as far as Seamus Scanlon. This is Canale. Again, lovely turn past Graham County. Great leadership given. Great accuracy of the pass. Tommy Walls well blocked down that time. It's by Owen Cadigan. That's a good block. And here's the young Douglas Clare to take it away once again. Out of defence. There was great speculation that he might start. He didn't. That might have been an error on the part of the Cork selectors. Kicked in this time. Held on to well by Colm O'Neill. Back to Kerrigan. Cork need a score. Can he provide it? He's kicked it, and he's kicked it to the right of the target again, and another one has gone astray.
Yeah, and in all fairness that time, I felt myself, Colm O'Neill won that ball well out in front of Tommy Griffin and should have actually got a free in, I thought.
It's nine wides now for Cork. Well, that's the one that went wide from Kerrigan. This is that brilliant block here by Owen Cadigan. Full of concentration, eyes on the ball, using his two hands well. Two Cork players go for this one. This one is taken down here by Alan O'Connor. He was fouled, free to Cork. They're getting every opportunity to launch their attacks, but their finishing has been poor. Extremely poor. Dunnock O'Connor. Mark O'Shea is out to try and deny him space. Still manages to get it in. Into Daniel Goulding. This man can be a winner. Goulding's doing well. Still Goulding. Blocked down well by Dermot Murphy. And there's a Kerry player there, Mike McCarthy, to pick up the pieces and get it to Darren O'Shea. And coolly and calmly, Darren O'Shea gets it out before he's fouled there by Dunnock O'Connor. And Kerry breathe a sigh of relief. Not for the first time in this year's championship. Dermot Murphy has come to Kerry's rescue. In fairness, it was blasted straight at him by Daniel Goulding. The angle was tight, hadn't much to shoot at, but the Kerry number one did really well.
You're right, actually, the angle was very, very difficult. Again, it's been lovely to see from a Cork point of view a player coming in on the overlap to take it at a better angle. All Dermot Murphy had to do was stand up that time and execute the save, and that was done with great efficiency.
Well, there's a yellow card for Dunnock O'Connor for repeated fouling. And that's where he got the yellow. Cork have possession, and that time it's Tomás O'Shea who's fouling. Tomás is Cork-based, incidentally. Oh! And there, kicked out of Graham County. And the referee doesn't take any action if he saw it.
I don't think anybody saw that, actually. I know there's a sub coming in for Cork at the moment. But again, definitely that time, I think Tomás had a straight foot in and drink Graham County, and is very lucky not to have been checked on it.
Paul Kerrigan's got to go off, and Fintan Gould comes on. Second substitution for Cork. This free kick will be taken by Dunnock O'Connor. Got two frees in the first half. We're now 14 minutes into the second. Doesn't look too happy, this young Cork fan. This one goes over the bar. It just might bring a smile to a few faces. Catches it well, it's travelling nicely, and it's over. It's back to a three-point game. Dunnock O'Connor's first point of the second half. Cork's first of the second 35 minutes as well. And it's taken a long, long time to produce. Well, now Kerry, with minimal attacking opportunities, are still holding on to a three-point lead in a fascinating All-Ireland final. They're playing and using the ball very, very cleverly, not wasting passes. And that time the frustration of Alan O'Connor evident, fouling Paul Galvin, who has stood head and shoulders among so many players out there in the park today, playing a wonderful game. Up as far as Darren O'Sullivan now, on here, to the breaking Tommy Griffin, anxious to get away from fullback and put pressure on the other fullback, Cork's Michael Shields. Out it comes to Anthony Lynch. The counter-attack here, with John Miska involved. Back towards Lynch again. Cork looking for another score to close the gap. Three between them. Alan O'Connor. Plenty of time to go. Still about 20 minutes of the All-Ireland final to play. Fintan Gould darting. piercing run in there, and it's stopped there by Tomás O'Shea, out as far as Tommy Walsh. But look how far back the number 14 has come to gain primary possession and help out his beleaguered colleagues at the back. And there's going to be a change for Kerry now, and it'll be Donica Walsh who'll come on. And the player going on is Tadhg Kennelly. Well, that is an interesting change. What do you make of that?
I'm quite surprised at that. I, Graham Canty certainly has upped his game somewhat in the second half, but I thought, you know, the very fact that Kennelly was on the pitch was going to occupy him, and that is a really big surprise to me.
Yeah, you consider, you know, this is the guy who's been a professional for 10 years and had been playing really well, I thought. Certainly the first half, he was excellent. Maybe he's got an injury. Killian Young, back here for Darragh O'Shea. Onto it quickly here is Mark O'Shea trying to get his way through a whole group of Cork players. He's fallen on the ball, held onto it too long. Free to Cork, Donough O'Connor taking. Huge one down towards Daniel Goulding, getting inside O'Sullivan, and then forcing it over the bar eventually. There was a goal chance there for him. Good play by Tom O'Sullivan, his marker. A bit of hesitation initially by Daniel Goulding. And in the end, very happy to see it crawl inside that right-hand post. That's where I thought he might have hit it. Wanted to get back onto his right and then onto the left again. It means there's two between them.
Yeah, there's only one team in the second half so far, and that's Cork, and it's been all Cork. They're mopping around the centre of the field. Alan O'Connor has really come into the game. You know, just there once again, Nicholas Murphy that time feels a great ball.
Cork are owning the game at this stage. They've had 8 scoring opportunities to just 2 for Kerry.
Yeah, but again, the pure fitter at the moment. They've raised the pace of the game. They're varying their attacks much better. If their accuracy had matched their endeavour, they will be ahead at this stage.
Gould's free kick down towards Goulding. Quite a combination. And back there is Tom O'Sullivan as well. Daniel Goulding pleading his case to the linesman across on the far side as Kerry tried to work it up along the Cusack stand side. That's Tomás O'Shea. Held back, free to Kerry. They'll take every opportunity they can now to try and build confident attacks themselves in measured fashion. Here's Declan O'Sullivan, great ball carrier. Miskala is after him again, a man who can run marathons, you feel, before breakfast. Here he comes again, back once more to Tommy Walsh. Having a go, hasn't got the accuracy, it's gone left and it's gone wide. That's a 5th wide for Kerry. They have few opportunities, they need to take everyone as well, just to reinforce their superiority on the scoreboard. Only 2 between them. We're in the 54th minute.
Yes, like the first half in reverse in many respects. You know, the attacks this time from the Kerry point of view are sporadic. That point should have been taken by Tommy Watson. Poor miss.
Cork try to win this one. And there was a push there on Alan O'Connor as it ran on as far as Pierce O'Neill. Didn't see an awful lot of Pierce O'Neill in that first half, but then that triangle or that diagonal group of players or diamond group of players didn't really function all that terribly well in the centre for Cork. Here comes Colm O'Neill, goal on the point in the opening 10 minutes. Recycling this one, holding it, teasing Tommy Griffin, his marker. Pass over hit to O'Neill, but he does well to get it to O'Connor, linking up with Canty. Now that Tadhg Kennelly has gone off, you would imagine that Graham Canty will be more and more seen as an attacking force, driving the side forward, showing the leadership. He's drawn the foul here, Donica Walsh hauling him down, some 30 metres out.
Indeed, there's only one team in at the moment. Cork have raised their game to a great degree at the moment. They're winning all the individual battles throughout the field, and I think that's the big thing, in particular around the middle eight, and they're just, that spirit is driving them ahead at the moment.
Those younger legs, I think.
Yeah, definitely, that enthusiasm, younger legs, but a huge variation to the game.
As Goulding kicks it, and Goulding, very confident now, kicks it over the bar for his 4th point. 2 in the first half, 2 in the second. It's a 1-point game. Cork won 9, but Kerry still the leaders on 13 points. 15 minutes to go, and Aidan O'Mahony is being prepared. Or is he? Back he goes to the stand again. I think it's Kieran Donaghy who's been prepared. We might see the star in very, very shortly. And you know, when he comes on, it means that Kerry sense that there's real danger to their chances of taking the title. Only once ever have Kerry lost finals back-to-back. That was in the 60s to Galway, 64-65. Here's Miskala. Cork look to try and draw level. Great ball, brilliant ball, all the way down to Dominic O'Connor, who made a very good run. Excellent block by Mark O'Shea. Some great football in this final. Out to Dara O'Shea. Quick look up to see who's making the movement for him. From the full back line comes Declan O'Sullivan, the number 11, who started up around full forward, now back helping out everybody required to win this battle. Tom O'Sullivan bursting forward, again laying it off sensibly to a player running laterally with him, Seamus Scanlon. Up here as far as Colm Cooper, the Gooch getting it in there, inside dangerously, in as far as Darren O'Sullivan. On to Cooper again. This spells danger into Donica Walsh. Back once more it comes to Tommy Walsh, high up into the sky. Does it travel sufficiently? It does! It's a fine point for Kerry. They may have been under pressure for a long, long time, but they gave Cork a timely reminder once more that they're a dangerous side in attack, and that's a terrific finish.
The boy has gave up a
Quirk comes in, and Darren O'Sullivan goes off. So the star has been held for a little while long. Is he in? He is in. And Darrow Shea's gone off. So a couple of very, very significant changes now, because two enormously tall players have come on for Kerry. Will that be the match-winning move with 15 minutes or thereabouts to go? Galvin, the taker of the free, to Tomás O'Shea. Inside towards Donaghy. Back once again to Tommy Walsh. Back once more it goes, this time to Walsh once again. One Walsh to another, and that's a lovely cracking shot over the bar by Tommy Walsh, putting over his fourth, having taken the pass from Donica Walsh. He's had five shots at the target in the afternoon so far, and the number 14 from Kerins O'Rahilly puts it straight between the posts to put three between them once again.
That's a fantastic score that time. Two fantastic scores indeed by Tommy Walsh. Again, a settled Kerry. And I notice Derek Cadden has come in now to mark, actually, Kieran Donahue's at full forward.
And he's come on for Anthony Lynch. First championship match of the season for Cavanagh. Well, now, who's going to win this final? It's advantage Kerry at this stage. And that, having conceded so much space and opportunity to Cork for the opening 15 to 20 minutes nearly of this second half. Graham Canty. Donica Walsh is the man who's marking him now, all the way down towards Goulding. We'll need a second attempt to try and get that, but Tom O'Sullivan seizes on it quickly before he's fouled by Daniel Goulding, free to Kerry. This was the 45th free kick of the final, I'm told by our statsman Tim McCarthy, as we watch this ball carried forward here by Colm Cooper. Kerry now looking the calm team. Tomás O'Shea hits it, and Tomás O'Shea fires it over the bar. Kerry looked to be firmly in command of the final. Four between them. Jack O'Connor came back to win it once again. Two shots from Tomás O'Shea, and he's fired over 2 points for Kerry. Invaluable scores.
Well, you can talk about fitness, you can talk about strength and conditioning, but you must have intelligence. And that kind of beautiful execution of intelligence by Colm Cooper. So Tomás O'Shea running into space, give the ball to O'Shea, the rest you all saw.
Six attacks by Kerry in the second half, and they've taken five scores. That's a push in the back that time by Nicholas Murphy. And Cork are absolutely rocked once again. They had all those scoring opportunities in the opening 10 minutes in particular of the second half. But Jack O'Connor's team, well, they rode their luck a little bit. But now they have once again put themselves into a marvellous situation to win back the Sam Maguire Cup, won last year by Tyrone, of course, when they beat Kerry in the final as Tommy Walsh kicks that ball away.
I've certainly been impressed with this guy since he's come in, on Cadigan. He's a good footballer. Okay, maybe Tommy Walsh has scored 2 points on him, but he seems to be much more solid as a defender than Kieran O'Connor was earlier.
Well, the free kick is going to be taken by Michael Shields. Well, now, can Cork produce some kind of rabbit out of a hat to try and win this final? Because they've had loads and loads of openings presented. They may need a goal. Nicholas Murphy there for Noel O'Leary, waiting for a support player. That's Donica O'Connor. Look at the number of Kerry players going back, prepared to put their lives on the line almost, ready to defend out to Paddy Kelly, still being forced backwards. This time it's Cooper back helping out. Everybody's back. Niskala forward for Kelly, got a great point in the first half, and this time under pressure he kicks it well to the right and he kicks it badly wide, and it remains Kerry 16 points, Cork 1 goal and 9, that's 16-12, 10 minutes to go. Yeah, but 11 wides now in all Martin for Cork.
Yeah, and we sometimes talk about the Kerry flair up front, but that quality of their defending has been absolutely wonderful. And I think Paul Galvin was involved in something late there and has got a yellow card, but just the way they're grouping in numbers and forcing Cork laterally is a real example as to how to defend properly.
Well, they've used their heads today and used it, used all that experience that they have. People said it would be a factor, and I think that's the way it has been borne out. Here's Noel O'Leary fouled. Still about 8 minutes to go and stoppage time as Donoghue O'Connor cuts inside. Still O'Connor, but again Kerry force him to hit it in quickly, and then at the back there are support players, and Tommy Griffin got there first to Tomás O'Shea, and Griffin again. Whatever about his tentative opening to the match, he has been one of the stars along with Mark O'Shea here. And what can you say about Galvin? He's run his socks off.
Yeah, the one thing about him at the moment, there's nobody in the half-forward line making runs for the half-backs when they're coming over the balls, and that's what's causing those turnover. But just watch that bit of anticipation again by Griffin, who has really grown into the game as he's come on.
Well, James Masters has come on in place of Daniel Goulding, and that's four substitutions now made by the team management. O'Connor kicks it in. Gould gets there. We've lost to Goulding, we still have a Gould for Cork. He's on the ball too long, fell on it, didn't play it. And as he handed it on the ground, it's got to be a free to Kerry anyway. Tomás O'Shea ready to take it.
Early on I said in the second half that Cork were winning the 50-50 battles. Kerry now seem to be doing that.
Well, it's been a wonderful game in so many respects because each team has had degrees of supremacy at certain times, and it's been a case of how well they use possession when they have that period of supremacy.
Yeah, an example once again that the bold strength of Tommy Walsh that time, holding off Owen Cadigan again, running in a straight line along the tram lines, was able to help hold them off. That's, you know, typifies the way he's played today.
So possession for Kerry. Marty Duffy making the call. Paul Galvin getting forward to join the attack. Once again it's Donoghue driving in on the baseline here. In difficulty back there, however, with Derek Cavan at his marker. Ball released as far as Graham Canty. Outside him is Alan O'Connor, trying to run through the heart of the Kerry defence now. It's Noel O'Leary. His team are 4 points behind in the All-Ireland final, and there are 6 minutes of action left. James Masters to crack one with his left and to put it wide. Another missed opportunity. Unbelievable.
Absolutely frustrating from a Cork point of view. They have got themselves into good goal scoring or point scoring up positions, but again, for whatever reason, they just haven't had the calmness or the poise to actually kick the scores when they have presented themselves.
They've had 11 chances, Martin, in the second half alone. They've only taken 3 opportunities.
That's right. Well, the old dog for the hard road, it must be said, Kerry with the fewer opportunities have made more use of them.
Great catch. Kirk doing really well, he's down injured. Tomás O'Shea has it. Beautifully in once again as far as Colm Cooper. Showing the necessary appetite in the second half in particular. Back to O'Shea. And Kerry will just use up the seconds, making certain that they don't just aimlessly kick the ball anywhere. It's an object lesson for other teams. Mike McCarthy, as I say it, he gave it away needlessly. And Cork have the opportunity of building. Derek Kavanagh slipped inside here as far as Miskala. Back to Kavanagh once again. Hitting it in towards Masters, his clubmate at Nemo Rangers. Comes bouncing back out towards Miskala again. Never saw him really as the running driving force during this All-Ireland final from the half-back line. It's Dominic O'Connor. Hit in dangerously, and again the goalkeeper collects it safely, and David Murphy links up here with Seamus Scanlon, one of the unsung heroes in the middle of the park. looks to be part of a winning combination for Kerry once again, but there is still some time. 5 minutes to go, 4 points the margin.
Yeah, but they're very much in control at the moment, and again they're being helped by the proficiency of the Cork attack, who have missed so many chances.
Michael Cusson's coming on, Alan O'Connor is going off, and Cork have now used their five subs. So Alan O'Connor makes his way, he's got a yellow card as well on his way off. And Michael Cusson on anyway, number 27. All 6 foot 7 inches of him. So let's see what happens for the remaining 4 minutes of the 70. We're watching Colm Goo-Cooper, one of the great geniuses of Gaelic football, get this ball across here towards the star. Released back there towards Donica Walsh, didn't quite finish as he wanted. He'll have been disappointed not to start. That's the sixth wide of the match for Kerry. But overall, Kerry have soaked up the punishment on occasions, the pressure from Cork, ridden their luck because of Cork's very poor shooting, but now find themselves just trying to play down the clock, run it down with possession here in the hands of Tom O'Sullivan, and Kerry enjoying a four-point lead.
They are, but again, I still think there's a goal in Cork, actually. I still think they're capable of a goal.
Tomás O'Shea. Again, making the passes count. Great movement to Killian Young. Kicked into space here. He didn't look up, and he gave it away to Cadigan. Canty now forcing it forward here to Miskela. Derek Kavanagh. As you say, Cork will need a goal up there to make a real finish of this one. Donica O'Connor trying to turn this way and that. Look at the number of Kerry bodies back there. And again they deny Cork, and O'Connor fouled, and it's a free out for Mike McCarthy and for Kerry. There was no way through.
No, wonderful defending again. Players helping each other out, getting themselves around the Cork attackers in numbers. Again, fantastic defensive play. Just watch this. Two or three of them not fouling again. Mike McCarthy eventually executing the turnover.
I noticed Tommy Walsh there coming off the Kerry team. I noticed that Aidan O'Mahony is ready to go in. I'm not quite sure who they put in the last couple of minutes.
Well, I say, well, Jack O'Connor is, he's going to play Aidan O'Mahony back. He's just going to try and crowd his defence. Again, if he just hopefully, from a Kerry point of view, not concede any goals.
David Moran, I think, has come in.
David Moran, yeah, I'm glad to see him coming in. I think it's overdue.
Yellow card for Tom O'Sullivan.
Well, I often wonder what it was like to be swallowed whole by an anaconda. But certainly, I feel today Cork must feel somewhat like that. They're still alive, but they know they're choking.
And still they are struggling to beat Kerry in a major match at Croke Park. They've never beaten them here. That was Moran kicking it forward towards Donaghy. It runs on there for Alan Quirk. 2 minutes to go. Out as far as Michael Cusson. Nobody on him. Kerry almost inviting him to bring it forward, see what you can do. They need two scores at least to tie it. Kicked in by Masters. Huge one in, dangerously so, and collected here by Mark O'Shea. Calmness personified. Did enough, took it out well. Out once again towards Declan O'Sullivan. He's had a superb match. Whether as an attacking player or back helping out his defence, everything he's done is at a touch of class about it. Aidan O'Mahony's coming on for Killian Young. And now it's almost like they're coming on to share in what is a victory performance by Kerry in this All-Ireland final.
Yeah, I'm glad to see Aidan O'Mahony coming on. Been a great servant over a long period of time. Again, injury, maybe loss of form this year has kind of prevented him from making the starting lineup today. But again, deserves to get a run.
There'll be 2 minutes of stoppage time played, and we're very, very nearly into that now, as you can see. It still carries 16 points. Cork, 1-9. His team have put on a really good performance. They benefited by virtue of Cork's very, very poor shooting, in particular in the second half. All those wasted opportunities. David Moran now sees that ball run away from him, and it'll be a line ball for Owen Cadigan and Cork. Kicked into Fintan Gould. Cork trying to add to their 3 points in the second half, as down towards O'Connor. There looked to be a nudge by O'Connor that time, got away with it. Comes back out here towards Cusson. Michael Cusson, the Glanmire player, gets it back towards Noel O'Leary. They're finding it impossible to get through. Brilliant defending by Kerry. Kicked in the end there by Colm O'Neill. Rather half-heartedly, a real hit and hope one in. Came off Dunnock O'Connor. Couldn't contain it. There's a minute left on the 120th All-Ireland Football Final. And you can see by the body language of Dunnock O'Connor that he realises the game is up. And that Kerry, with 21 scoring chances, two fewer than Cork, would look to have their hands on the Sam Maguire Cup once again.
Well, it's quite amazing. They were the league winners, the stumbled through the qualifiers. They should have been put out of their misery down in Tralee, but that innate survival instinct once again activated. Glorious against Dublin, functional against Meath, but damn good today.
Canty kicking it. Huge one in. Opportunity here for Dunnock O'Connor to... Oh, that just about sums up his and Cork's afternoon from right in front of the goal. Conor Coonahan realises just wasn't his day.
It's quite amazing, Ger, actually. Again, you know, today they explored the depths of the spirits. Looks as if they've claimed their 36th All-Ireland. But that wild desire, you know, that sense of entitlement that they feel, it's theirs when they come up here to Croke Park. And, you know, where it's Tyrone today, their mindset would have been different against Cork. They simply believe.
Very few seconds left now. The referee blows his whistle. Kerry win the All-Ireland. Kerry are the All-Ireland champions. It's their fifth All-Ireland success this decade. Jack O'Connor came back, wanted to win it one more time, probably had Tyrone in his sights. It was Cork instead. They didn't beat them in the Munster Championship, but they've beaten them here in the big one, in the All-Ireland final itself. It's Kerry's 36th All-Ireland title. And once again, they get the measure of their great old rivals in Munster, Cork, in a game at Croke Park. And Colm Cooper finished the afternoon with 6 points. Ty Kennelly came back from Australia to emulate what his dad did and his brother Noel back in 2000. Look at the smile on his face. They'll be looking at his pictures all over Australia, I'm certain, as well. Because Ty Kennelly has won the All-Ireland medal he wanted to win to go with the Premiership medal he won back in 2005 with the Sydney Swans. You know, Cork, 1 point from play in the second half, 2 points from frees. It simply wasn't good enough. And Ty Kennelly and Kerry can celebrate.
And they fully deserve it. And again, they deserve to be spoken of in the same breath as the Golden Boys and the boys from the 70s and 80s. They may lack the individual brilliance and the class and artistry, but the O'Shea's from Dingles, indeed all the Dingle contingent, the Border Boys, the lads from the Cork and the Limerick border, along with the lads from the South, they would have regarded defeat today to Cork as an aberration and something they wouldn't countenance. But it was their spirit today after an appalling start that was manifest. And again, Kennelly, Galvin, absolutely wonderful, I thought, when the game was in the fire, when the game had to be decided. And throughout, it was just that bit of experience, that little bit of being here so often, that ultimately, you know, gave them the victory that they thoroughly deserved.
Over the years, they've had the answer against Cork when it really, really mattered. I remember in 2007, people were saying, well, if Kerry lose to Cork in the All-Ireland final, what's that going to say for all the Munster Championship wins they had in Cork and in Killarney down the years? And today, there was a feeling that Cork couldn't possibly afford to lose it for themselves, but they have. And it was all those misses in the second half, you know, 14 wides, 10 in the second half alone. That is a horrible statistic.
Absolutely terrible. And again, it goes back to the whole thing. You peak in September.
The final score here, it's Kerry 16 points, Cork 1 goal and 9. Kerry are the champions, and they are going to celebrate it, and well they might. You were talking about the zigzag road that they took to get here, Martin. You know, just thinking back, they really could have been beaten by Sligo.
Well, they should have been beaten by Sligo. Indeed, were it not for a wonderful save by Dermot Murphy from David Kelly late in that game, they would have won it. But take a Darragh O'Shea today in his 81st championship game, you know, going and winning what is it, a 6th All-Ireland medal.
Yep.
Ty Kennelly, you know, coming home to get the Golden Fleece, forsaking a professional game to come back here. But every one of those lads, they were absolutely written off early in June. You know, a lot of people conveniently forgot that they were the league champions. They were shocking, I thought, in the qualifiers. But once we saw them against Dublin, we knew, hold on a minute, these guys have a kick and a spark left in them. And today, if anybody had any doubt, they saw that this is the team of the decade.
If I could mix my sports ever so slightly here, they remind me in a way of Italy when it comes to World Cup. They somehow crawl into the finals, playing awful stuff in the qualifiers, and before you know it, they've gone off and they've won it.
Yeah, and I think we should mention Cork, actually. You know, they have a number of emerging tyros. I think they'll have a team for the future, a very, very good team indeed. And today's experience will be devastating, but at the same time, it's not something that should actually see the end of them. This should be a beginning for them, and I think myself, you will see a lot more of them in the future.
I've no doubt about that. There certainly is going to be a title in Cork, because they've got so many fine underage sides. They've won the All-Ireland Under-21 title twice in the last 3 years. And now it'll be Christy Cooney, a Cork man, who will hand over the Sam Maguire Cup in just a moment.
Yeah, but that one had to be as sweet as any one of them, I think, Ger, because so many people had counted them off, you know, had written them off this year. And again, I'm just looking at the display of some of the lads there today. You know, Colin Cooper in the quiet game by his own standards. Tommy Walsh was outstanding. Declan Sullivan to me made all the difference in the first half. I need the three half forwards really, you know, roasted the Cork half back line. And that to me was where the foundation was laid.
For a tremendously sporting game. I've no doubt Cork got bitterly disappointed. You've had a wonderful year, Mark, and you shouldn't be downhearted. I'm sure your day will come. But today we dance to the kingdom. Their fifth title in this decade, and they carry on a proud tradition of wonderful Kerry teams. I applaud you, your management, and your county board and your clubs for your wonderful achievement in winning 5 All-Ireland titles in this decade. And now it gives me great pleasure to present Sam to a wonderful captain in Darren O'Sullivan.
The most famous trophy in Irish sport is handed over to Darren O'Sullivan. Sam Maguire goes back to Kerry. They are the winners for the 36th time. A wonderful final victory.
Uthran the Heron, Uthran the Bubalu Class Gale, August the Corda Galair, Tana Thurm, Uncurrent Shaw Glacker, Erson Munchir Kiri! I can't put into words how much this means to me. To stand here in front of such a fantastic group of players and an unbelievable management team, and just to look out at all these Kerry supporters. I just want to thank the sponsors, Kerry Group. They've been brilliant again to us this year. They never ever leave us wanting. And I hope our relationship continues for many more seasons to come. To our backroom team and medical team, I can't say enough for them. They've bent over backwards for us, and we're always there, and they're always there waiting for us. No questions asked. And the management team, our two physical trainers, Alan O'Sullivan and Pat Flanagan. I just want to give Alan Sullivan a special mention because the hard work he's done all year, especially with the injured fellas. I think Kieran Donnelly will tell you exactly how hard he worked to get Kieran back here now today. To our selectors, Gerald Keith and Eamon Fitzmaurice, who put their lives on hold this year for this team because they had faith that we still had the ability to come back here this September. And to the man who put the management team together, and it was his belief that brought us through all the tough games this year. He never once questioned us. He always believed that we'd come here, we'd stick together. That man, Jack O'Connor. And to all the supporters, we made you travel far and wide this year, but you really did come out in numbers. And when we were struggling, you were the one pulling us over the line, so thanks very much. And I nearly forgot him. He's below smiling as usual, Pat Flanagan. Pat's been involved with us for a long time, and he's the only one that can keep me smiling at training anyway. On a personal level, I just want to say thank you to the Ulster Bank there, one of the main sponsors this year, and my employers, and the work and the help they've given myself and Kieran Donnelly this year has been amazing. Cork, we were there last year, we know exactly how hard it is. But you've had a fantastic year. I think we just got the rub of the green today, but you can hold your heads up, you've been absolutely brilliant, and I'm sure your time will come in the future. Three cheers for Cork. Hip hip. Hip hip. Tossam, except the Walla.
Well, a great speech by Darren O'Sullivan from Glenbleigh, Glencar. Got the captaincy by virtue of Mid-Kerry winning the Kerry Championship last year. And he's here in the sunshine of Croke Park this afternoon to help lift the cup. There's Mark O'Shea. Tom O'Sullivan now from Rathmore, right on the Cork border, along with another colleague of his from the Gardaí, Aidan O'Mahony, there to lift it also. Borig Reedy didn't play today, but coming in to share in the glory. Tomás O'Shea, who lives in Douglas in Cork, and all the other subs, David Moran, who came on, and they will bring that cup back with them, back once again to the kingdom. It's their day.
It is indeed, and our thanks to Ger Canning and to Martin Carney in commentary this afternoon. Joe Brolly, Colin Bourke and Pat Spillane with me here on the panel. Always doing the dance. Well, remember Ty did that when he won his medal with the Sydney Swans in Australia, and what an occasion it is for him. Brilliant to see. Paul Galvin played his part in this championship this year as well. Pat Spillane, congratulations to everybody from Kerry. What a journey it's been this summer.
That's been some journey. It's been a roller coaster ride, but you know, Michael, form is temporary, class is permanent, and at the end of the day, systems may come and systems may go, but like the Kilkenny hurlers, if you produce skillful players year in, year out, fill them with belief and get commitment, you know, the cream will always rise to the top. You know, it's time in Kerry now that they forget about the Mikey Sheehy's and the Pat Spillanes and the Bomber Listons, because we really have another team.
They're just there, that's fair to say. They'll never forget Pat Spillane.
We have a team of legends there, and in particular, can I just mention to you, Ty Kennelly, I soldiered with his father for many, many years, and he'd be a proud man up there tonight.
Ah, there's no doubt he will. Colin O'Rourke, I'm sure you want to add your congratulations.
Yeah, well, Kerry just have a certain class which no other county, you know. Tyrone, to be fair to them, matched them and beat them in All Irelands. Otherwise, Kerry would have won everything for the last decade. But today there was a certain inevitability about it. In a very poor second half, I thought, Cork with plenty of possession, kicking wide after wide after wide, and then Kerry would come down and.
One of the greatest midfielders of all.
And you have very rarely, I think, will you see ever again three players of the quality of the O'Shea's. And Dara had a great game today, as did Tomás and Mark. We probably will never see three brothers like that again. And this man has probably been the footballer of the year. He's a certain eccentricity about him, but I'd love to have him on the mead team because he does all that sort of dirty work around the middle of the field where he wins possession. But
you know, it was sort of dead by a thousand cuts for Cork in the second half. Miss after miss after miss, and then Kerry come down and get a few easy points.
Martin Carney put it very well, I thought as well, Joe Brawley. He talked about the anaconda syndrome in the second half. They gradually were tightening the grip and squeezing the life out of them.
Cork were extremely disappointing in the sense that, you know, they accepted their fate from an early stage. You know, all of their key players disappeared. You know, I said after the semi-final that, you know, that Cork had done Kerry a tremendous favour. And in a way, when you were watching the game today, you know, there was a strong sense that Cork simply weren't at the level to compete with Kerry. I mean, after they'd had the opening burst and they went 5 points up, Kerry just, you know, bossed the game. And, you know, we were talking out there, we were agreeing that Kerry didn't even play anywhere near their best, and yet they cruised through the game.
Yeah, all right. He did the little dance. He's won an All-Ireland medal. Here's Kerry's Tyken lead. He's with Marty Morrissey.
Kerry now looking the calm team. That's Tomás O'Shea hits it, and Tomás O'Shea fires it over the bar. Kerry looked to be firmly in command of the final. The referee blows his whistle. Kerry win the All-Ireland. Kerry are the All-Ireland champions. The most famous trophy in Irish sport is handed over to Darren O'Sullivan. Sam Maguire goes back to Kerry. They are the winners.
Hello there, and you're very welcome. On the night, Kerry are crowned All-Ireland champions. It's the last Sunday game of the season, but my goodness, we're going out with a bang, because in an extended programme, I'm delighted to say we're joined tonight by a host of Ireland's most famous players and managers. As we reflect on the season, we mark the GAA's 125th anniversary, and of course, we'll talk about the big points from today's final that saw Kerry emerge as All-Ireland champions again. Well, this was the scene earlier as the Sam Maguire Cup arrived back. He gets some welcome home, and later we'll be joining those celebrities and the celebrations down at the Winners Banquet. They'll be getting lots of post-match reactions. What's been a great day for the county once more. Well, tonight we're going to have an action-packed programme as we look back on All-Ireland Final Day 2009. Coming up, highlights and analysis of today's senior final as neighbours and old rivals came head to head for football's most precious prize. We'll look back on the 2009 championship season. We'll celebrate 125 years of the GAA with no shortage of memorable moments. We'll be naming our team of the year with plenty of debate, as always, on just who should make the first 15. And to wrap up another season of Sundays, we'll be naming our man of the match from the 2009 All-Ireland Senior Football Final. Yeah, and I'm delighted to welcome our panel tonight. Daryl Kaneda, Kevin McStay and Tony Davis are with us. They'll have lots to talk about later on. But first, let's recap on the drama at Croke Park. And we begin by capturing some of the sights and sounds long before the teams or even the spectators had arrived. Sam Fosi Malia, actually Dunamore, I suppose. Dara, it's been an incredible year for Kerry, a kind of roller coaster year, hasn't it?
It's been a very weird kind of a year for Kerry. You know, I suppose we all travelled up in the quarter final stage against Dublin and expecting, you know, to be going home as a funeral cortege, and it just turned at that point. There were so many turning points during the course of the year. I think Kerry have learnt an awful lot from last year's defeat as well. I think, you know, they certainly weren't the best team over the course of the summer. They were the best team on the day in the All-Ireland final, and particularly the way they learned so much from Tyrone last year as well. I think that's one of the big lessons that they did learn from Tyrone, that you have to peak at the right times, and it's timing is everything in this game. And Kerry certainly got their timing right today.
What did you think of it as a match, Kevin?
I would say overall, most people viewing it would have said it was a good contest. Kerry won it, I would say, without really needing to be brilliant. The Cork challenge faded just when it mattered. In an overall sense, I don't think it'll go down as one of the great All-Irelands, but Kerry proved that, come September, they don't tire of winning All-Irelands, and they were the masters there. You know, every question that they needed to get sorted in the last few weeks, and the people they needed to target, the lines they needed to target, they did that. Absolutely terrific effort by them.
Right. Tony Davis, you were a dejected man when you got back from Croke Park.
I was a broken man, Des. But I suppose, first of all, I'll have to congratulate Kerry on their performance today. Again, they proved that they can do it on the day. They really performed very well and they had the best footballers today. There is no doubt about that. For Cork, it's heartbreaking for Cork. Having beaten Kerry and Tyrone, you would say at the start of the year, whoever beat Kerry and Tyrone will win the All-Ireland, but not so. They must learn to perform on the day, on the big day. And that's what Kerry did. They have the players, they can take their scores. And listen, you nearly want to stake in their heart and see them buried before they're out of the championship. They're just some side and we must congratulate them on their performance today.
You've been very magnanimous about it all.
We have to be.
Well, yes, I suppose there's not much else. We'll get into it in more detail in a while. Let's go to the audience. Jack O'Shea and Larry Tompkins are there, lads. Jack, as a midfielder, Dara O'Shea has been something, hasn't he?
Phenomenal, yeah. I think that, he picked up his sixth All-Ireland medal today. That's a great achievement for Dara. I think he's, over the number of years he's playing, he's been outstanding. I think he's grown as a player from the beginning. He was a bit uneducated, I would say, early on, but he's learned a lot in the last number of years, and he learned how to pace his game, and now he's learning how to pace himself over the last couple of years, and I think he's an outstanding footballer, and I would congratulate him as a midfielder on gaining six, but he's one more to go days to catch me, that's all I'd say.
Larry, it was a great start for Cork, and why do you think, what turned it so much?
I just think probably from the offset, I'd say that the Cork probably were afraid that Kerry might get the dream start, but it was Cork that got the dream start, and you would say it should have settled them, there's no doubt about that. I'm sure the players know themselves that a lot of them didn't perform on the day, a lot of things didn't go right.
But they did perform though, Larry, for the that first 10-15 minutes they were flying.
Well, 70 minute game, Des, it's not a sprint, it's an endurance test, and if you win all errands, you must go out and really play to your full potential. I think we've seen there from the clips there, easy free has been missed, easy chances have been missed. And the amazing thing about it, with 15 minutes to go, even though Carr played, I would say a lot of players performed very poorly, with 15 minutes to go, there was a point in that game. So, you would just probably question Kerry on the day probably weren't at their best either. And I don't think it was the greatest All-Ireland final of all times, but Kerry won't mind that tonight. They won again.
Well, Mickey Hart and Mickey Ned O'Sullivan are over here. But Mickey Hart, Jack O'Connor deserves special mention tonight. They say you shouldn't come back, but it worked out for him.
It certainly did. I think all credit to him. It was a big task to come back there, and there was only one answer when he did come back, is win the All-Ireland, and that's a huge risk in the current climate. But he has done that now, and full credit, as we say, to Kerry. They were written off probably more than they've ever been in their lives this year, and I think they've fought back in the right way.
And Mickey Ned, you would have witnessed a lot of the problems Jack had to deal with. There was, the discipline issues, changing a lot of the team, losing Kieran Donnelly. He had a lot to deal with, hadn't he?
Well, I think there's within every camp, you're going to have problems. It was just unfortunate that they got out. And normally these are dealt with behind closed doors. This year, unfortunately, they got out. Mm. And it's part and parcel of the management part and parcel of every team in the championship.
Yeah, but when it gets out, it does become more difficult, doesn't it?
Yes, it's damage limitation after that. And it could affect morale, but fortunately, they pulled through the qualifiers and had the big performance then against Dublin, which restored confidence.
That seems to have been the whole turning point for the year. Were they the best team this year?
I think probably Cork played the best football, but for some reason today they didn't play the style they played all year. They didn't put the half-backs on the back foot. They tried the ball in, there was no movement inside, and they persisted on that.
All right, then, well, let's go and hear from them. We're going to hear lots more from the audience later on, but now we're heading to the happiest hotel room in the whole of Ireland, and there amongst the Kerry supporters is Michael Lester. Michael.
Yes, thank you.
On there amongst them, can't you? Well, let's go back to our audience. Kieran Whelan of Dublin and Sligo's Eamon O'Hara there. Eamon, is every Sligo person saying, but for a penalty, we would have beaten Kerry?
Possibly.
Did it cross your mind today?
It did. There's no doubt about it. I suppose you look at the whole occasion, and you know Kerry did trip the way into an All Ireland final, barred the Dublin game. But we had our chance, and it's probably the story of every county team, 32 county teams or 33 county teams. You know, missed chances, and we lost the game. Unfortunately, and the result hasn't changed. But you know, Kerry went on to bigger and better things, and we were knocked out of the championship. Des,
if you had won that match, would that have been your biggest victory ever, even though you've got Connacht title medal, etc.?
It would have been, Des, yeah, no doubt. You know, Kerry have, you know, such a strong tradition, and for somebody like Sligo to push them as far as it did was fantastic. But I suppose it's the expectation that we have within ourselves. We felt that we could go down to Tralee. Nobody gave us a hope. We performed okay. We didn't play particularly well on the day ourselves, and we would have, you know, we've looked at the video and said, you know, we should have done things a lot better, but we had the chance, and you know, you cannot blame David Kelly for missing the penalty. We got there, he took the shot, and it was saved, and a great save by Jeremy Murphy, but you know, that's the way it goes.
Right. With that big fellow beside you there, Kieran Whelan, who's just retired after a distinguished career. What, you started, am I right, just after Dublin won the All-Ireland, and 14 years later, it's been an illustrious career, and no All-Ireland medal. On the All-Ireland final day, do you think about things like that?
Yeah, you do. It comes into your mind, Des. I suppose I started 96, was brought into the panel when Dublin were All-Ireland champions. But, you know, Dublin have won two All-Irelands in the last 32 years. They're the facts of it. And there's a lot of players around Dublin that will finish up without All-Ireland medals. Yeah. But, you know, like Eamon says, ours wasn't a missed chance. Ours was a hammering. that's the end of story. Kerry just blew us out of the water on the day. And it was a disappointing end to the year for us.
Was that a freak result in your view? Or is that unfair to Kerry to say that?
Well, Kerry just performed on the day. You know, we always felt once Kerry got back to Croke Park that they're a different side, and they'd stutter through the qualifiers, but they got off to a rip-roaring start that day, and we just never recovered. And you know, it's very hard to pinpoint what went wrong, but you know, in fairness, they just blew us out of the water.
Yeah, there's a lot of things went wrong. Well, good luck in your retirement. You're going to stay involved, are you?
I'll stay involved. I'll play a bit of club football, all right, and I'll take a back seat and take it easy for a while.
All right. Well, good luck. Thanks for being with us, Kieran. We'll be chatting with lots more of our distinguished audience as the programme goes on, but a reminder about the great prize in our competition, because RTE Sport, a special Sunday game programme where we have an illustrious audience with us, and we're going to be chatting with them as we go along through the programme. But first, let's get reaction to today's final from the unfortunate Cork team.
You get 70 minutes to perform, and you've got to perform over the 70 minutes. We probably started that game reasonably well, maybe took our leg off the pedal, and you know, in fairness to Kerry, they stuck in there, got the scores, and you know, in the second half maybe we had a few chances to come back and claw back. We'd possibly be a bit disappointed without that.
Yeah, we got a very good start, and you know, that's what we were probably aiming to do. Kerry, to be fair to them, came back strong, and they, you know, they took their chances. I don't think they kicked very many wides in the first half. We had a few chances maybe that we could have turned the screw a bit more. We were still within touching distance at half time. It was only 2 points in it, so we felt we were in a great chance, and we got it back to a point. But you know, they just kept us at arm's length for the last 10 minutes, and you know, I suppose maybe that was experience, and maybe a bit of lack of experience on our part, but you know, that's the way it goes.
You shot 14 wides today. It's an awful lot, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a high figure, but you know, you're supposed to be more disappointed if you aren't creating the chances. You know, there, I suppose, maybe the second quarter we weren't creating chances. You know, the second half I think we created the chances, but you know, just didn't take them, unfortunately.
I'm probably the oldest player on the team, so certainly a lot of the guys coming through are, you know, coming into their prime in the next year or two, and you know, I'm not sure what guys, you know, what their plans are for the next year or so in terms of the older guys, but I'd imagine everybody will be on board again next year. But it's, you know, it's about trying to put this behind us, I suppose, and you know, doubling our efforts maybe next year.
Yeah, Darren's just telling me Alan Quirk's getting married next Friday, so good luck, Alan. I hope you have a good weekend next weekend. It's tough after the day that's in it. Let's go back to the audience. Willie Joe Padden from Mayo, you experienced the heartbreak of defeat in the final. Do you think fans understand what it's like for players on a night like this?
Ah, certainly they do, yeah. As I said, we've had enough of our heartbreak down through the years. I might get a few tips here maybe from Sean Boylan how to win one. Maybe it'd be good. But the fans do. Like, they appreciate what the players have put in, the sacrifices they've made all year. And I suppose, it's equally very hard for Cork tonight because, they did beat the two best teams in the country, or the two teams that you would imagine would be the two teams that you would have to beat to win in All-Ireland. But unfortunately, when it came down to the final today, Kerry, really had their homework done, and they really had their appetite and they had their hunger. And I think that, as some of the lads said there earlier on, like, they did stutter through the, the qualifier. But when they needed to play a big game, which was against Dublin, they produced it. They played a mediocre game against Meath. Come today to the final, they had to be at their best, and certainly when it came to the test today, that they were up for it.
Right, Sean Boylan, a word about Conor Coonan. He hasn't had a bad 15 months of whatever his manager.
No, he's such a calm man. He's put his own stamp on it, and he's moulded a lovely team together. Because a couple of years ago, they got a really bad defeat in not Ireland final, and it's hard to come back from that. And they've regrouped. They brought in the younger players. Today, they just met a Kerry team that were stung early on, and they reacted very quickly. And once they got back on top, they weren't going to let go. They never lost their attention for a moment, and it was very, very difficult. It must be very frustrating for Cork because they had so much ball and yet couldn't score, couldn't put it away, couldn't get a movement going. It was just a frustrating day for them because all through the championship, they've been very, very impressive coming from the full back out, but didn't happen today. But let's hand it to Kerry, let's give credit to where credit is due. And but knowing Conor, he'll bring them back. It won't be the end of the world as far as he's concerned. He knows the potential is there. He knows there's great possibilities in the team.
Yeah.
And I don't think it'll be too long before they have their day in the sun as well.
All right, Sean. Thank you, Dara. As Sean says, give credit where credit is due. You were a forward with Kerry, but you were hugely impressed with the Kerry defence.
Yeah, Sean mentioned the final of 2 years ago as well, and I think at that stage we got Kieran Donaghy, Colm Cooper, Declan Sullivan, all these lads getting all the kudos, but definitely today was a seriously good defensive performance. And I suppose, again, they've learned so much from Tyrone. They play without fear, bad start, and they grew into the game, grew in confidence, and very, very disciplined in the tackle. Mark O'Shea shadowing Donoghue O'Connor, as he did all day, putting him into positions where he doesn't want to be kicking from. Yeah. Paul Galvin tracking back. But the full back line discipline is excellent here. Tom Sullivan just given an inch on the shoulder the whole time, ball being cleared. And Cork did exert huge pressure. I know they kicked a lot of wides. Some of them could be attributed to bad kicking, more of them could be attributed to the pressure Kerry were putting on. Mark O'Shea, a player who would have been coming in for a bit of criticism this year as well, like Tommy Griffin and Tom O'Sullivan also coming in for criticism. They were felt might have been a bit vulnerable. Tom Sullivan here shows that he still has the legs at 30, 31 years of age to take off up the field and set up a crucial score at a very vital stage of the game. And it's just the confidence these lads show. It's a high ball across the square. There's no question about who's claiming it. Mark comes out of nowhere, claims it, and goes right across the line, plays it with a bit of confidence. And again, I honestly think that these lads are learning an awful lot from the defeats that they've had, that they're just playing on instinct, playing a fear of fine footballers. People would say they probably have too much football for a full back line trio, but they were excellent today, and they were the bedrock in which the whole win was
not unlike, I suppose, Tyrone had the footballing full back line, and It's becoming a key
You look at the job that Tyrone's full back line did last year, when all the talk was about the Kerry full forward line going in, and they played on instinct, on the shoulder, without fear. Those things could have gone seriously wrong for them, but they played at that level, and Kerry did that today, I feel. After 10 minutes, it couldn't have got much worse, so they decided, go out, let's play, and play on the edge, and they did that very, very well today.
Just one final thing on that, in your praise of the full back line. The Kerry half-back line didn't really allow the Cork half-forward line do much either.
They didn't, but I think that would have been anticipated coming into the game. You had two lads there on the wings who were going, would have been a huge pressure on them to play a big game. Kerrigan and Kelly, they were coming in with big reputations and having had a good year, so their names were up in lights already. Pierce O'Neill, likewise, Mike McCarthy, kept them very, very quiet today. They do deserve an awful lot of credit, but I just a little bit more impressed with the full-back line for their just fearlessness right throughout the game.
All right. Tony, don't want you to start having to knock your own fellas, but Cork didn't play to their potential.
No, they didn't really. And I suppose one of the main points is, and the start of the second half, well, it was 1-6-11 at half-time, and Cork won the ball for the first 10 minutes of this, and they just didn't take their chances. Here we see Paul Kerrigan kicking the ball wide, and this is just an example of quite a lot of other shots. Now, all the talk before the game was Kerry's free-taking. Did they have a free-taker? Now, Cork do have three free-takers, and unfortunately, again today, they're all scoreable frees. Daniel would kick them over the bar ordinarily and didn't do it again today. And some of the shots here again, Dunica out in the wing, he turns in on his left and kicks it wide. Again, Dunica on another day would have kicked that over the bar. But what it showed overall was Cork's lack of experience. Some of their, they had three forwards playing in their first All-Ireland final. It's a whole new ball game. Totally new. You have to live up to, you have to get used to the whole occasion. You can be good all year, but it's the day the cups are given out, so it's, they must get it right on the day. Their attacking play as well was quite poor in the second half. They just lost their shape, they lost the style they played with all year. It's just something they must learn. When we played, I look at Sean Boylan and Martin Connell down there, 87 and 88, they beat us in All-Ireland finals. They'll be hungry, they'll want to come back again. They're a young team and they can learn from it, but they must take the positives from it and drive on. They're a good young team and hopefully we'll see them back again.
Okay then. There was speculation about what the Kerry attack would be, who'd be in, who'd be out. Tommy Walsh was back in and he certainly made an impact.
Well, he did, and I believe it was a fantastic contest down in down at training between himself and Dunica Walsh, but they gave the nod to Tommy Walsh, and they'll be pretty thrilled that they did because he had a huge influence in the game. This is after, you know, maybe 20 minutes or so, there are four points on. That's a terrific pass in from Tomás O'Shea. Yeah. And Tommy Walsh is now coming into the game. Yeah. He subbed off against Dublin, came on against Meath. So there was a few question marks about what his contribution was going to be. But he was absolutely brilliant. Power, like for such a big guy, you know, he has lovely touches as well. And sure, there would have been a sense that he wasn't throwing the ball around as much and he wasn't scoring the points. You get the odd spectacular goal and so on. But now this is the second half and there's only a point in it. And this is really squeaky bum time now for Kerry. Can they push on? And now he's on to his left foot. And the lads were talking about it today in the studio, where he's connecting with the ball high up, very difficult to block, and a terrific, and this is the score of the game. Lovely little interchange of passes. But watch Tommy Walsh when he gives the pass. Comes around the back, as all good forwards should, and that is absolutely terrific. Yeah. Nails it.
Well, funny enough, Des, we spoke about this last Sunday night in our preview, and we assumed all the time that Tommy Walsh was going to start, but when you talk to the people that know down in Kerry, they were saying there was a certain doubt about it. I couldn't understand why there was a doubt, because he's perfect for the Cork full back line. He's a big, strong guy. We saw what he did against Anthony Miles. He came on and got 1-2 that day, 1-3. Yeah. It's very hard to defend against somebody that big, and with the kind of ability he has, he can kick scores like that. He has to be on the team.
Right, well, speaking of big men, for me, one of the highlights today, probably wasn't seen by our audience who were at Croke Park, but immediately afterwards, Ty Kennelly was interviewed, and given, you know, the year he had, a huge gamble, obviously he lost a lot of money by giving up the Aussie rules to come back, but it was a very emotional moment when you remember, of course, his dad has won in All-Ireland, lots of All-Irelands, his brother Noel has won. But let's just recap on Tadhg after the match with Marty.
I'm very, very happy. Put a lot of work, I suppose, leaving in the first place 10 years ago. And I thought I would be here well before now at the age of 28. But very, very lucky to come back my first year and to reach an All-Ireland final and to go through what we did. And personally, look, like I said, the years haven't been too easy over there. Mm.
But Tadhg to win the Premiership in 2005 and then to win an All-Ireland in 2009, I mean, it is a unique and fantastic achievement. You must be so proud.
Yeah, I am. Look, I haven't thought about it. Look, Marty, it hasn't really sunk in. Look, I've just been thinking about my father, really, to tell you the truth. So it's good. I'm a very, very happy man.
I'm emotional myself a little bit there.
I think with Tommy, and what probably people don't realise, or with Tadhg, what people don't realise is when he came back, the injection he gave that Kerry panel is unbelievable. You know, that they felt that this guy was leaving a professional game, that it was worth his while to do what he was doing. Mm. And to play the game that he played today, he ran himself into the ground, gave Graham Canty fierce trouble right throughout the game, and I think that was applied by the management, they take him off and put on somebody else who would run him into the ground as well. But his kicking, and you could see the incremental improvement in his game right throughout the summer. He was improving, even though I heard an interview with him during the week where he was saying he was sitting on the sideline against Sligo with a broken bone in his hand, hoping against hope that David Murphy would save this penalty, but he really contributed in a big way. But I think his biggest contribution
contribution was actually just coming back in the first place and letting the other 33 or 4 lads on the panel know that this was something worth fighting for, that this was something worth giving up something for. And, you know, it is one of the big stories of the year, without a shadow of a doubt.
And great for his mother, Neil, and the family, as he said. But Kevin, the perfect ending to the story could have been different because Cork fans were unhappy. That first or second minute tackle. Mm.
Well, the story could have been stillborn, of course. That's the truth of it. It's not a good challenge. The referee is in a great position, in my opinion. And he's very lucky that's the first minute. It is a sending off offence. Yeah. He's high, it's reckless, he's coming at speed. I can only assume that Marty Duffy didn't see it in the way we've just been able to see it in slow-mo, because he would have had to issue a red card if he viewed it perfectly. You know, them's the breaks. It happened in the first minute. He gets to tell the great story, and he had a huge influence in the game. Mm. If he's sent off there, well, they have to do a lot of rejigging, and he's not going to have the big influence in the game. So I suppose that's the talking point. That's why Corker a wee bit sore about it.
Frustration
certainly, because just from looking at that incident, he let that incident go, and I thought he just pulled up for petty incidents in other parts of the field. Cork were 1-4 to 1 point up at one stage, and I thought some of those frees were very soft. And as well as with the Kerry, I thought Cork got some soft frees off him as well, from petty enough kind of stuff, you know. So okay, it's a balance. But if he got sent off for the first minute of the game, the result could have been different. Now, no one wishes.
It was a big day for Marty Duffy.
A big day for him as well, and particularly with all the talk before it as well. It's an awful pressure to put on him. So listen, that's the way it goes.
He didn't make any decision, in my opinion.
Well, he didn't
change. Yeah, he didn't cost Cork the All Ireland. That's
Kerry were the better team, without any doubt, and that's it. But still.
All right, let's go to our audience. Donegal's Martin McHugh is there. Martin, what did you think of the game today?
I thought the match was actually won today before the game started. Jack O'Connor got his tactics right. It's the first time this year that Canty and Miskell have been put on the back foot. Yeah. And by putting Tygan Elliott centre forward, but he played Canty closer to his own goals. And, you know, he didn't get up the field like he did before. Then he took Declan O'Sullivan and put him into the full forward line. Now, normally in the Munster Championship, Declan O'Sullivan was always being picked up by Miskell. So they had a decision to make to either leave him in the half forward line with Darren O'Sullivan on him and having the ability to run at Miskell. So I thought he got it right. And if we go back to the game in Munster, the two matches in Munster, if we look at the Kerry team, it's a completely different Kerry team. Different fullback, different centre half, Seamus Gallen in the middle of the field, a different centre forward and probably a different full forward. Mm. So I thought Jack O'Connor has to take a lot of credit for today's match. And I thought Cork got it wrong on the field. When the six forwards they had, they were trying to play low ball into the full forward lane, someone's kicking high ball, and it wasn't being won inside. I thought they should have put customs in and changed their style of football at a stage in the second half.
Right. Mick O'Dwyer, the talk of Marty Duffy, a lot of it came from a press conference with you and Billy Morgan.
Yes, somebody said that, all right, yes.
Yeah. But were you critical of the appointment of him?
Oh, God, I wasn't. I wouldn't be critical of any referee, to be very honest. But I think Billy and myself had a bit of a chat. And, well, you know, there were on occasions that I was involved with teams that he was refereeing, and I wasn't too happy with his refereeing. But generally, overall, I thought he did a very good job today. He let the game flow, and I think that was very, very important.
And for a flowing game is what fellas want, isn't it?
Well, it was. I think he let a lot go in the first 10, 15 minutes of the game, you know. And I think, you know, the hurling game the last day was something the same. And I think it was an offshoot from that. I think maybe the decision was let the game flow. And, you know, if there is a little bit of pulling and dragging, let it go. I think that's what we like in the game anyway. A lot of the people that go to games, they like to see a bit of that stuff going on, a bit of good hard football, which has gone out of our game. So there was nothing wrong. I thought he did a good job today, to be honest.
All right, okay. Kevin Walsh, as manager at Sligo, we spoke with Eamon about the famous day in Tralee. Well, is it a very different Kerry team today, do you think?
I think it is, Des. Going back to the day in Tralee, I think that was the first time they actually brought Mick McCarthy back into the team. And people were saying, you know, maybe it was only Sligo, they were just trying it out. But you could see from that moment he was trying to blend them in, and he was a huge player today. You know, he kept Pearse O'Neill very quiet, and Pearse O'Neill had been a big figure in the Cork team up till now. And, you know, you'd have to, like Martin said, hats off to Jack O'Connor in the way he tried out the team and had it right for the day.
Eamon McInerney, the tactics now in football, there's a kind of negative element, is there, or a more defensive-minded element? Is that a fair comment to modern-day county football?
You know, I think that people all over the field have a job to do now that they didn't maybe have in the past, that the onus is on them to tackle back. And, you know, you saw Paul Galvin in a lot of clips there back tackling on his own 20-metre line. And I think that has just come into the game simply because people are trying to kind of
the other teams are doing. And, you know, you can't blame any manager for trying to maximise what his team has.
Sure, OK. Thanks, Eamon. Well, time now to reflect on what was a very tense minor final as Armagh took...
Both counties have been starved of underage success. Armagh's last and only title came way back 60 years ago in 1949. Mayo, last year's beaten finalists, have lost four finals this decade. Their last win at this level came back in 1985. Well, Armagh opened the scoring with a Rory Grugan free, and then centre forward Eugene McVerry added to that tally to put Armagh 2 points to the good. But Mayo were soon level. A Brian Rutledge free and a fine score from midfielder Danny Kirby made it 2 points apiece. In truth, it was a poor enough first half. Both sides guilty of some bad misses, but a bit of late quality from Mayo and Fergal Durkin in particular meant the sides went to the break level at 4 points apiece. It was Mayo who got the first score of the second half. A blocked shot fell to Fergal Durkin, who set up Brian Rutledge, and he put Mayo ahead for the first time in the game. But, like the first half, the sides continued to trade points. Robbie Tasker levelled for Armagh before Eugene McVerry got his third point of the afternoon to put Armagh back in front, 6 points to five. Again, Mayo hit back to lead by 7 points to six, but it was Armagh who came good in the remaining minutes of the game. Tasker put over a point from a difficult angle to level up the final at 7-all. Thomas McAlinden then added to Armagh's tally to put the Ulster side a point up. And in the dying moments, Peter Carraher put a two between the sides. As an insurance, the impressive Tasker scored his third point of the second half to put Armagh 3 points up. The ball just doing enough to clear the Mayo crossbar and good enough to ensure victory for the Armagh boys. Armagh's captain, Declan McKenna, receiving the Tom Markham Cup, winners by 10 points to seven.
Cork McManus of ESB is here to present our minor man of the match, Andrew Murnan, with his award.
Congratulations, Andrew. Fantastic performance. Well done.
Well done, Andrew. 60 years is a long time to wait. How does it feel now that you have bridged that gap?
Oh, brilliant. Best feeling ever.
It was such a tight game as well, wasn't it?
Yeah, we had to work real hard. The backs especially had to put the work rate in to get all around that field, get the ball.
I know people would say we're a long time learning, but I'd still prefer to be here on the All-Ireland final. There's a lot of counties I'd love to be here, and we set out our stall at the beginning of the year to be very competitive, and you know, I'd say we were fighting a bit above our weight with a bunch of lads, a lot of them lads underage next year, and you know, I'm very proud of that Mayo team.
All right, Kevin McStay, I know you're disappointed obviously as a Mayo man. What do you think of it as a game?
Yeah, it wasn't a particularly good minor final. Everybody that watched that would say it was a poor stuff. I'd say that the nerves just got to the two teams and the big crowd, and it is a big occasion, you know, for 18, 17 year olds. And it's a very thing to get, stay composed throughout. It wasn't a great spectacle, lots of errors. But I would have to say that the best minor team in the country have won the All-Ireland now. Armagh, I think it's their 18th competitive match this season, and they've won all 18 of them.
Yeah.
For the Mayo guys, and you can see the disappointment in Ray Dempsey there, we have a number 18 to contend with as well. This is our 18th major final since we last won it in 85, and we've only won one of them, and that's patchy form to say the least. The expectation with this team for Mayo wasn't huge. I think the expectation on the Armagh team was huge. That did not help Armagh today. They struggled. I'd say probably their poorest performance of the year, but they still knew how to win it, and when it was there for winning, they pushed on and did the business.
Yeah. Yeah. You were concerned, you thought tactically it was...
Yeah, it was a very tactical game, and it was crying out for somebody to kick points from distance. Now, we did have some good points from distance, but I think maybe with minors as well, their kicks wouldn't be as long as senior players, and they kind of like to get the ball a bit closer to goal. But it was crying out for a long-range kicker, and when the kicking needed to be done, the likes of Robbie Tasker now stood up to the mark. And I think Armagh showed fierce courage as well in taking off Eugene McVerry, like, who would be their most experienced player, had been playing reasonably well in the first half and had been playing probably their best player all year. And they did that. It was a big call, and the substitutions worked well for them.
And crucially, Tony, like in all big games,
yeah.
Strong finish.
There was a kind of a deja vu about it. They were tight in the game and you were looking for someone to kick in and drive on, and it was Armagh kicked in and drove on in the end, and they got three vital points. Thomas McAlinden got the first point. Here we see him coming in. He kicks a very good point off his left here from about 35 yards out. The next score was by Peter Carragher in midfield to make it 9 points. Again, good win. And on the outside of his right foot from 35 yards over the bar. And Robbie Tasker gets the next one. Robbie Tasker, a beautiful footballer. Their full forward have been magnificent all year, but this guy really showed up in every game. Every game I saw. I saw the Ulster final when they played down. Good player. And to scores like this, winning all earns, and I'm sure it will give them confidence to go on and go and play senior. But again, it's hard for the Mayo people. I'm kind of a closet Mayo fan. I'd love to see Mayo at some stage break through that glass ceiling, go on and win an All-Ireland. I think they deserve it. But as Ray said, it's great to be there and competing, but it just must go the next level.
All right. Well, the Mayo senior manager, John O'Mahony, is here. Are there positives for you, John, in it?
Well, I mean, they are, of course. It's good to be competing in at All-Ireland final level. I just go back to an earlier point you made about feeling sorry for the lads that picked the team of the year. They're all right, they don't have to manage it, as you know. So, I think that there's some fine footballers, there's some fine work going on at underage level. And, you know, Kerry haven't won a minor title since 95 and they're winning All-Ireland. So it's not, you know, compulsory that you have to win minor titles. But I think I'd agree with Kevin there. He said earlier that both teams are very nervous. An All-Ireland final is a special animal, and I think we saw both teams affected in the minor, and we saw Cork affected in the senior, and Kerry are there every year, so that it's like playing in their backyard, you know.
Which is in contrast to the Armagh minors, and former GA president Peter Quinn is here. Proud Ulster man, another underage title for Ulster, but that's a big one for Armagh, isn't it? They've waited so long.
Well, the last time they won it was 1949, 60 years ago, when Greg Blaney's father was captain, Blaney, was captain, and then he emigrated to Down, and of course Down and Ross Carr's here beside me, they reaped the benefit of the change. But of all the Ulster counties, Armagh's the one that probably has played most underage football over the last 20 years and got nothing out of it. I mean, they were very unlucky in 1992 to lose in the very last minute.
Yes.
And I suppose that affected them to some extent for a couple of years after. Today will be a big benefit to Armagh football. They won the under-21 2 years ago. They're after winning the minor. If they get four or five players out of each of those teams, then you'd have to say that there's the prospect of a good Armagh team 3 or 4 years down the road. And I suppose in terms of Ulster, the Ulster Championship for the last 2 years hasn't been particularly good. A good team coming through, Tyrone is at the present time head and shoulders above all the rest of the teams. A good Armagh team coming through would certainly strengthen the Ulster Championship and maybe allow Ulster teams to go forward and win at senior level. But of course, not that long since we had a win at senior level as well.
Don't be lamenting it so soon after. All right, Peter, thanks very much for that. Well, still to come on our extended Sunday game, the All-Ireland Final Man of the Match Award, our Team of the Year, magic memories for some of our audience, and reflections on the 2009 Championship season. See you shortly. Extended Sunday game, we have the Man of the Match Award, the Team of the Year coming up. But first, on the GAA's 125th anniversary, let's enjoy some very special football memories from down through the years.
Team to win some. They've done it! Tyrone of the All-Ireland champions!
Well, looking around the audience, there's so many memories. And Mick O'Dwyer, Kilkenny went bananas last week with the 4 in a row. You got the 4 in a row, of course, in 1981.
We certainly did, yeah, and the man alongside me here was the man that stopped us from getting 5 in a row.
He did, indeed.
So you could have a word with him there about the nudge or the push, whatever it was.
This was one of the better goals, was it, Mick? This one against Offaly in 81.
I said one of the great goals, actually.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well worked.
And of course...
Jack, was it Jack?
Yeah.
Come on, Jack, well done.
I'd rather you describe it than Jacko, because he'd take ages telling us how good it was. But, That 4 in a row, and we talk about keeping teams motivated and keeping them going, The five in a row, was that heartbreaking for you when you lost in the manner you lost it?
Well, it certainly was. I suppose we were in a position to have won it all right. There's no doubt about that. We missed a penalty early on in that game as well. But I suppose justice maybe was done in the finish, you know, when you come to think of that. It was a good, very good Offaly team. Yeah. The year before that, we played them, and we had a wonderful game in the semi-final against them. We scored 4-15 and they scored 4-10. So they were a team that were on the way up. And there's no doubt about it, they deserve to win an All-Ireland title. But it certainly was heartbroken because we put a lot of work into that team. It was a marvellous team. And that team, we failed to win the five in a row. But to just show you the character of Kerry footballers, right down through the ages, we came back to win three in a row 2 years later, you know?
That's right, yeah. It was a fair achievement. Well, getting to that so-and-so then beside you who ruined it for you. Seamus Darby, how are you? Nice to have you here.
Nice, thank you.
The Kerry fellas, do they always bring it up when you meet them?
There's more than the Kerry lads bring it up, unfortunately. I suppose every day of my life I'm listening to it, you know.
And we're looking at it here now, yeah. And where's the nudge, Mikko? Oh, yeah.
Would you think so? Is it a shovel or a nudge?
There was no nudge, Seamus.
I didn't think so, anyway.
I didn't think so.
Peter McGrath didn't think so.
Yeah, exactly. That's
they were too important, Peter.
And Seamus, when Mikko was talking there about the really high-scoring match, I think Matt Connor, I remember, scored a massive score in that.
You know, in all fairness, that when you score 4-10 in an Ireland semi-final, or in any game, you'll expect to win it.
Yeah.
Matt Connor was one of the great players of any time, of any era.
Sure.
He scored 2-9 that day and still was on the losing side. So I think in all fairness, Offaly had a fairly good team. We were back again in the final the following year in 81 when Kerry beat us, and then we were back again in 82 again. So I think, you know, I know Kerry were a great team, but we had a good side as well.
Absolutely,
and, you know.
And it was one of the great finals, actually.
It was one of the great games, apart from the goal or whatever.
Yeah.
It was, and it was nail-biting all the way up to the final whistle, you know.
Well, I suppose as you had your two finals, but the 1-2-5, of course, there's lots of the Cinderella moments, I suppose, as we'd call them. And Seamus Clancy from Clare is there, and Clare beating Kerry in the Munster final in 92. That was something else. Do you have vivid memories of it still?
It's too long ago nowadays. It's too long from a Clare point of view. It's definitely too long ago.
Right.
I expected we'd have one more since, but we haven't, and you know. We're still the heroes, and we're waiting for new heroes to come along, and the sooner the better.
Have you looked at it in recent years?
No, but I did see it. I see my young lads watching it on YouTube or something like that lately, and they said, come on, watch this.
That was Marty's famous line, wasn't it? There won't be a cow milked in Clare tonight.
Yeah.
And my favourite bit that came out of that, Seamus, was Aaron Zyle won the Leinster Club final, I think it was the following year. And Keith and Johnny Barr were being interviewed, and Keith said there won't be a cow milked in Finglas tonight when they're interviewed after. Well, there's a man sitting up behind you, Seamus, Declan Darcy, who featured in Leitrim's Connacht final win, which was, I mean, everybody from Leitrim came back for the All-Ireland semi-final from every corner of the world, didn't they? That was special, Declan.
That was very special, yeah. Like, I mean, at the time we wouldn't have realised it, I suppose, but now when you look back on it, and particularly for Leitrim people, because, you know, things weren't going very good, and, you know, everybody kind of half-laugh about where Leitrim is or what it is, but that day they could stand tall, and they were very, very proud. And but for us, as a team, it was just about winning a game and winning a Connacht title, and that's what we were about. Obviously, now when you look back on it, you can see the emotion and what it meant to people. Mm. But then, like, it was just another game of football. We wanted to win it.
And John O'Mahony, of course, brought you there.
Hi, well, John is... top class. In the minute, I suppose he was the one that gave us the confidence when he decided to come to us.
Yeah.
He kind of knew, obviously, we knew if he was coming to us, he must have thought there was something good there. So it gave everybody a bit of confidence. And then, of course, like John is top man, and everywhere he goes, he has success.
He has, yeah. But John, you must get a kick out of that one. I mean, you have, as Declan said, had success elsewhere.
I remember before I went, Des, I was told there'd be a statue built on the bridge in Carrick and Shannon. I'm still waiting for it, but it was a wonderful, wonderful occasion. And you know, we beat Mayo in the final on that day. And I'll never forget. You know, there was people from Mayo that went to cheer, obviously for Mayo, but they ended up almost cheering for Leitrim and stayed on the pitch with us. And We toured the county the day afterwards, you know, which you don't do for provincial finals, you know. The Kerrys are the Tyrones or whatever, are the Mayos, put the cup and the provincial cup in the boot. But we toured the whole county. Yeah. I remember arriving back on the Tuesday morning, it was bright. you know, that there's wonderful memories. Sure. And Declan obviously was a wonderful leader, and there was an all great people involved.
Yeah. Over here on the other side, Barney Rock from the Dubs is here, and Kieran Whelan was talking earlier about, you know, how few football All-Irelands there have been in the last 30 years, but 83 was so memorable. The final, the Dirty Dozen or the 12 Apostles, when you had three sent off depending on where they're from, but the semi-final victory over Cork and the dramatic goal you got was such a key part of it too, wasn't it?
Yes, I think in 83 the goals... Yeah. I suppose the one in Croke Park was the one that made it, coming back into it, and just the last kick of the game. That was a special moment. And it was the first time we had a trip outside of Croke Park, because in them particular stages, we never went outside Croke Park for any championship matches for quarterfinals and semifinals.
Yeah, and the replay then was manic with all the Dubs that went.
It was. We went down the day before. We stayed overnight in the Blarney Park Hotel. And we had a fantastic time. Heffel let us out on the tear the night beforehand. We went into the park, and some fellas had a pint or two and others didn't. And we came out and played the best football we ever played the following day against Cork.
You've justified the theories of every manager in the room there.
Just wanted to mess it up a little bit. They wouldn't be able to do it now.
Pat Gilroy, don't take that as a message, is my plea to you. Well, Sidney Crosby is... Dublin had a great rivalry with Meath, of course, and Martin O'Connell is there. Meath, the Dublin rivalry. But then, in the late 80s, Meath and Cork developed that great rivalry. And I suppose winning that first All-Ireland for you must have been great in 87, was it?
Well, it was, Des, yeah. I suppose when you win your first one, it's nice. It's nice when one or two or three, but definitely your first one, it's lovely to win it, yes.
And again, you had lost the semi-final no more than we've heard other teams had to lose before they won. Isn't that right? So coming back and winning it. But there was to be a massive rivalry between Cork and Meath.
There was, for some reason. I don't really know why, but... when you look back, then it was probably stupid really at the end of the day, you know, and it was just one of those things. Like, we often went on holidays, and I remember being over in the Canaries. I think Cork were one side of the pool and we were the other side of the pool, and we wouldn't even talk, you know. So when you think back on that, it was really stupid. But because of it was, I don't really know why it was, but that's just the way it was, I suppose, you know.
Tony Davis.
It wasn't actually until John Kearns' funeral when all the Meath guys came down, and we kind of said, listen lads, this is stupid, it's only a game of football, you know.
That's right.
But it was intense and it was silly at the time. But when you're in the trenches, Martin, and you want to win, your whole life is about winning, reality goes out the window, doesn't it, really? It's all about winning, you know, when you're in there.
Yeah, absolutely.
But the trenches are fine, but the swimming pool is fine.
We could have ended up in the pool the way we were.
We were all sitting around the deep end. There wasn't too many good swimmers.
I was going to say, if you weren't a swimmer, you wouldn't have gone out there. That other day, so yeah.
Well, it took John Cairns' view, unfortunately, it took that thing to crack the thing, and we were glad we went down, and we'd talk and chat now and play a bit of golf again, so it's good to see that.
Yeah. There's a lesson here for every under-12 team who hates the parish next to them, by the way. But, Peter Quinn, we're talking there about Ulster at underage level, but the 90s and the noughties, or whatever you'd call this decade, I mean, the transformation for Ulster football in the last, you know, 25 years is incredible, isn't it?
It has been fantastic. I suppose Ulster had a very difficult period between 68 and 91. Mm. And football really wasn't highest on the agenda. I'm not saying that when teams went out they didn't give their utmost or that they didn't train as much as anyone else. But really there were lots of other things that were distracting them. And from that point of view, I suppose, it was a different country. And then down came, and really they came from no place, because at the start of that championship nobody gave that down team any chance of winning an All-Ireland, and they came and won an Ulster championship and got to the All-Ireland final and played well in getting to the All-Ireland final, and then had that fantastic game against Meath, a game that
Donegal then in 92,
then Donegal in 92 and Derry in 93, and then we had 94. The game in Celtic Park, which for anyone who was there will be remembered as long as they live, because that was the best game of football I ever saw. Derry and Derry. in Celtic Park in 1994. Yeah. A game where the lead changed in the last 5 minutes three times. Nobody knew who was going to win it. But it wasn't just the fact that it was so exciting. The standard of football you were talking about, as it turned out, the 1994 champions playing the 1993 champions. Yeah. It was an absolutely fantastic game of football, refereed by one of the best referees in the country at the time. And it's just, for those who were lucky enough to have been there, and unfortunately there weren't enough there to see it, but it was special. It was by a long way the best game of football I ever saw.
And sitting alongside you there is Ross Carr, who savoured seeing some of those moments again. It was a very special time, but that was a great down team you were part of, Ross.
Yeah, I suppose history always decides on who's great. A
couple of All-Irelands, those.
Yeah, and... At the odd get-together that we would have, I suppose we have a few regrets that we didn't win maybe one or two more, but at that particular time, you had very, very good teams, as obviously Donegal and Derry proved, but Derry were a fierce team at that particular time. And
what do you mean by fierce?
They had some fantastic footballers, and you know, while we might have regrets, I'm sure that team, that Derry team, for only to win one All-Ireland, would have a lot of regrets too, you know. But it was, I don't know if any era is better than any other era. It was just different. When a lot of the fellas here played, it was knockout system, so there was no second chances or whatever they may be. And but since the backdoor has come in, you know, in August and September, we've had great games too, you know. But I would say that we had great times, and I see Martin across the alleyway there, and he's a butcher by trade, and he's very good at it too. He was good at it at half back too.
He marked him, didn't he? he had good meat to work on with you, Ross. That's for sure. Well, while we're chatting about memories here, it's time to get memories of this season, and these are your memories, because according to our poll on the RTE Sport website, these are your 10 favourite moments from the 2009 season.
Hannon lines up this kick to win. Hannon has drawn it in, and it's over. What an incredible kick. He is ice cold in Ockram.
Back in towards Canty. My goodness, he's made up some ground. Great ball inside here towards O'Neill. And O'Neill blocked and put in the back of the net by Daniel Goulding.
Looking for Trevor Mortimer, who does well against Finian Hanley. Across towards Conor Mortimer, it's in the back of the net.
Here's Cal, formerly fullback, played midfield, still going through, still Cal, brilliant!
Jamie Queenie, he's got to score from here, Queenie, and I think he's done it. Yes, he has. That is a brilliant score.
Paul Kerrigan wanted it, now gets it. And it's a good ball into Kerrigan. Goal!
Declan O'Sullivan has taken up a great position far side. Griffin a couple of yards away from him. They're letting the forwards get the ball and trying to take it back, which is impossible with these guys in this sort of form. O'Sullivan with another point. This is glorious football from Kerry.
Kevin Brady almost let it out over the end, over the sideline. James Lockery feeding it in. This is Crozier. He's had a couple of goals and he puts this one over the bar. Justin Crozier. Antrim beat Cavan and reach the 2009 Ulster Football Final.
This is Jonathan Davey coming through the heart of the Kerry defence. He's inside this large rectangle. He's brought down. It's a penalty for Sligo. Has to be. David Kelly facing Dylan Murphy. Brilliant save.
Inside. Donoghue O'Connor has a support player. Back once again to Goulding. Is that a penalty? It is. The teams are level. Dermot Murphy waits. O'Connor composing himself. And striking it well off the post and in.
Right, that's your top 10 of the season up until today. Darragh Kinnaird, what's your highlight of 2009?
Well, the highlights of 2009 would have been the Kerry's first half performance against Dublin in the All-Ireland quarter-final. I think it's rare enough you have the privilege to be sitting in the stand and just, you realise there's something special going on. But I suppose, to put it in context, I think the game before that against Antrim, very few people saw what Jack O'Connor saw. You know, Mike McCarthy and Paul Galvin, there was encouraging signs and nobody saw this coming. Yeah. But the Kerry team were very well supported that particular day because I think a lot of people thought this was it. But to be even there watching, even for example, Dara Shea standing in the middle of the field, giving a masterclass in midfield play without actually moving that much, you know, just calling his wing forwards, orchestrating the great game, cracking...
That's the classic midfielder, yeah. Classic. The others do the work, yeah.
Yeah, cracking Stephen Cluxton's kickouts. You know, I think it was, you know, close as we got this year to footballing perfection.
Right. Kevin McStay?
I was I went a little bit parochial, Des.
Right.
The Connacht final this year in Pearse Stadium, and the context of the match was very interesting. And that we were 6 points up at one stage, and Galway brought it right back. We're getting heart attacks at this stage, and then Paddy Gardner has the composure, I suppose, and the execution. It was a terrific score against the breeze. You know, the winning point. I think the ref blew it up on the kick out. You know, to win it in those circumstances after such a long period of time, unable to win in that venue, and of course when you're beating Galway into the bargain. It was special. It was pretty special.
Tony Davis, your highlight.
Yeah, I suppose I went to something that tried to highlight something that I thought was very apparent this year, and that was sportsmanship in the championship. We didn't hear too much about the CCCC or the DRA or anything like that this year. I thought right through the championship this year, it was quite good. And the bit I picked was against Sligo and Galway above in the Connacht Championship. And I didn't know Eamon O'Hara was here tonight, but Eamon was booked beforehand. All right, and here we go. An incident happened in the game, as happens in games. He gets booked for that. Here we go again a couple of minutes later. Down goes Michael Meehan and gets on with it. No messing, just gets up and gets on with it. And it shows good spirit and not trying to get somebody sent off or anything. There's no diving or any messing like that. He gets up straight away, goes up to the referee and says, listen, we'll get on with it and we'll play football. And I just thought it showed a good spirit by Michael Meehan and a good refereeing and get on and play the game.
You owe him one anyway, Eamon, I'll tell you. And so Jackie Meehan is on your Christmas card list, I take it.
Fair play, Romain. There was absolutely no contact at all. Just in my own defence.
But while we're in the audience, let's ask a few others. Kerry goalkeeping great Declan O'Keefe is two away from you there. Declan, have you a memory from this year, a favourite highlight?
I suppose like the other day, I suppose the Gooch's goal against Dublin. Yeah. Really transformed Kerry's season, that match against Dublin, and they lay down a marker in the first minute of the game. Mike McCarthy surging run into the Dublin defence, and Stephen Cluxton's a brilliant shot stopper, and he was out very fast in the Gooch.
Yeah.
It took a great finish to put it in. It was a really outstanding goal, changed our year.
And was it partly because you weren't expecting it?
Yeah, a lot of the Kerry fans travelled to Dublin that day in trepidation, really. And yeah. Wondering how much we'd be beaten by. I met a lot of people and they were wondering how many pints we'd be beaten by, but put up a great performance and, as I say, transformed our year. But I thought it was a great draw to get. I remember texting Eamon Fitzmaurice before the Antrim game and saying, if we get over this one, we're back into the big time, and it was the draw we needed, Dublin. Nothing for a Kerry footballer, nothing better but to get Dublin and Croke Park, and worked a treat for Kerry.
Sure did. Sean Boylan, what was your highlight of the year?
Oh boy. I suppose on a personal level, to see the way our own county came back after where they were last year. They got an awful doing last year, sort of against Wexford and then against Limerick. And against Dublin, they were very disorganised at the start. And then somebody was going to say to us that they were going to go so far in the championship afterwards. Yeah. It was great to see the county back there and back competitive again. And even though they mightn't have excelled in many areas, at least the heads didn't go down. The old fighting spirit was back. And that was a huge thing.
Yeah, sure.
It was great to see it again.
Pat McEnany, referee, as a neutral, perhaps, had you a highlight of the year?
My highlight probably was not sending off Kieran Whelan here beside me. I've got plenty of stick to go along with it.
And did you do Eamon O'Hara during the year?
No, he's always liable for a yellow card, though. I suppose Antrim's emergence and Sligo doing pretty well, and I think the back door worked pretty well this year. But, you know, I think all the laurels rest with Kerry tonight and Michael McCarthy's to centre-half.